and foremost. They're a team that has these very famous streamers. Sungyeon and Snowfall are famously a duo streaming partnership where they always play together. They're very well known here among the fan community in Korea. But for KT, a team, a professional organization, to lose to professional streamers is humiliating.
And Najin already suffered that fate, so the question is, can Anarchy, without that element of surprise, because of course that was the first series and everyone was like, wow, look at Mickey, he's so good. They didn't actually account for his just pressure around mid, and the Lyra-Mickey duo ran over Najin in that three-game series. A lot more respect's been paid around Mickey, and that's why it was kind of notable that when they picked up the win over SKT, Mickey was what, maybe third or fourth on the list when it comes to crediting who really drove that victory.
Indeed. And that Cassiopeia will be banned against Nogne. Has been a solid pick for Nogne. He's played it a lot this season so far. His most played champion. Now Ryze, of course, banned on that red side. KT feeling that champion is very much first pick, first ban worthy at the moment.
I feel like Anarchy probably want to be on the red side. They probably want to go for that assassin like you mentioned, but so much harder to do so on the blue side. It's always possible that the early pick mid will come through from KT if there's a really high priority pick, but much easier to go for that assassins when you have the flexibility of red side fifth pick.
Yeah, the only one you can really pick up safely is that LeBlanc.
Sure. And it hasn't, I mean, it's been fine, but it hasn't necessarily been the Zed that we saw against Najin.
Sure. So Alistar also removed here by KT. Kalista a bit surprisingly banned by Anarchy. Sungyeon apparently not comfortable in that champion.
Ahri
against Nogne. And talked about that a little bit earlier. I'm not impressed by Ahri as a champion right now, and Mickey plays it. So I wonder what this means.
It's really peculiar. This must be a very specific mid lane champion wants to pick up, because literally Nogne got kind of embarrassed on this champion, solo killed by Varus with his jungler watching in front of him.
I think this is a first pick victor. That's what I think.
It must be.
It must be. That's the only sense that we can make of this right now.
It's shouting out for a victor. Of course, Hecarim's another pick that they really value. Sivir also for the Sivir-Hecarim synergy. There are a lot of picks that are up, but Victor, a lot of the champions that deal well with him in lane are on the ban list.
Yeah, the one thing you have to worry about is that Gragas, though. If they first pick Victor, giving up the Gragas could mean that Victor gets knocked right into the front line.
So the old KT, that I mean, basically the eight-game run that we're talking about, the big thing for them was their power in the drafting phase. Suddenly, we're already talking about priority picks that need to be snapped up. At least on paper, there is a very strong red side two picks, Victor, for example, available to be picked up by KT.
Yeah, and I think they have to take it away right now. Otherwise, you know Anarchy's going to go for that champion. We've seen Victor be pretty high priority here in Korea among many teams, and of course, banned out in all of our games in the previous set.
Victor Thresh?
Yep. Definitely a possibility if they want to deny the ability for Snowflower to make plays on the lane, and someday he's in a battle right now for off-meta champions with Faker, wanting to go for that Yasuo, perhaps in the top side. And we have not seen new Ashe in Korea yet.
It's not really a surprise. Famously, when Jinx was released, every other region picked it up, and Korea just wasn't going for it. In fact, we talked at the time, and you were just basically saying, look, no escapes. It's going to be slow for people to pick it up. Probably going to be the same story with this Ashe.
Okay, well, it is Annie Sivir. So KT is going to react to their recent tough times where they used to be this team that just loved to tower dive you with Sivir and Annie. Towards the end of last season, they were just all in you, very quick, very high kill wins. And it looks like they're going to fall back on that strategy once again.
And guess who was banned in both those games against the Koo Tigers? Koo banned Sivir both games.
Yes.
And Arrow, he struggled on other champions, but Sivir's so much more straightforward to get going.
KT is a team that loves Sivir, I think, unlike any other team in this league. Very reliant on that champion at the moment.
A lot of power left in the draft. We mentioned the Thresh. That was the MVP performer against SKT Telecom T1. They picked up that big win on was Snowfire on the Thresh. They're going to lock it away, and the Corki taken as well. The lane matchup's just fine. The power spike errs more on the early side. Big question is, if you see that champion, it really does shout Zed, doesn't it? You've got more magic damage coming through on the lineup. I'm thinking Assassin Flavor is coming in the mid.
I love Assassin Flavor.
What does Assassin Flavor taste like?
Dried blood, smoke.
Hmm.
That's how I like my scotch.
Bit of ash as well.
Yeah, a bit of ash. All right, Maokai, consideration right here. Another dive champion, someday famous for his ability to flank and score, maybe taking another stab at this Nunu. Now, score has typically been a very good Nunu, but just extremely passive against the Tiger.
And they had that amazingly weird comp we mentioned before with the Ryze and Nunu, where they didn't have any synergy with the Blood Boil. And Sivir, again, not really a big Blood Boil user, haven't been moving towards the Azir. So they move away from the Nunu, again, earlier power spikes with the Rek'Sai. Wait and see where Aniki go with their drive. They can go really any way. They can go for the Varus Corki.
It's really strong with the Gragas.
The Varus Corki Gragas is, again, very similar trio that Ku Tigers were able to use to take down. So KT has seen this firsthand once already.
And what would they play, actually, against that Varus with the Ahri ban that was a champion that Kuro managed to solo kill Nagne with, that Varus into Ahri matchup, but apparently the respect is there for Anarchy as they look to blind pick a Varus and potentially a Cinder Hulk Fizz in the top side.
One of your favorites.
Indeed. Well, it's a strong 4-1 composition, I'll give them that.
It's actually very good in lane against Maokai. We have seen Maokai's win the matchup, so it's maybe tenuous like the Rumble Maokai that we saw multiple times in the previous series. And speaking of that Rumble, the Yodel finds a way, and they go with Rumble.
Yeah, great poke off of turrets here for Anarchy that basically they can drop Explosive Cask or Equalizer to solidify a siege and take out a tower. I really like that combo.
I agree completely. Excellent siege when you've got the Corki and Varus, and it's mixed damage siege as well. Very high line physical damage, very high line magic damage with the Corki rockets. And as you mentioned, Explosive Cask, it's not the old AP Gragas where you just throw off a cask, half health, everyone get them off their turret, but it's the same thing. You're going for turret damage by pushing people and displacing people away, and they're going to look for an assassin. They'd already banned the Ahri. They're wondering what's left in the pool, and it might be Fizz.
It might be Fizz, but that will leave them with limited wave clear options in the
Sivir.
mid lane.
Sure.
And especially if a 4-1 siege starts, they may have some trouble. Instead, going for a Twisted Fate, the back line initiation. That's a great pick, actually.
That's nice to see. We haven't seen a lot of Twisted Fate, but it has been starting to crop up. It matches the wave clear of the Varus. Both of them have very high line damage when it comes to either the wild cards or the Q. Can I look to take the cleanse? I guess thinking more defensively, that will hurt his roam and his global initiations, but he got so much CC in lanes from the likes of Annie, from the likes of Maokai. CC in general, massive on the side of KT.
Well, this is how they like to play. Very aggressively going for the dives, going for the ganks, and then just snowballing very, very quickly in the game. So KT kind of returning. Now Anarchy putting together a composition like the one that the Ku Tigers used to beat them, maybe sensing that they're going to be weak to this siege. They certainly looked it, but this time, KT has a much better draft. They have the tools to disrupt this backline. And that Varus, if Nagne gets Azonias, is dead.
And that's a really good point. They're playing against it, but look at the adaptation. Now they have Maokai with the flank engaged with the home guard potentially. They have Twisted Fate, as you mentioned. Even has the cleanse to guarantee the gold card into the Zonyas. Will not be able to CC him and kill him before the Zonyas. And even Annie. Flash Annie with the Sivir speed. How do you stay safe as Mickey and still do damage? He's got a lot of range, but it might still not be enough.
I don't think this is enough. There are too many tools to attack the back line from KT now. And if they can hit an item power spike, the Zonyas on the TF could very well seal this game up. Well, it's Anarchy versus KT Rollster game one. Let's get into it. Anarchy, a lot of fans tonight.
They're growing. Growing as an org, growing with their popularity. It's good to see. They've just taken a win off SKT, so what other time to really get into full voice? Sure, not a series win, but a game nonetheless. And I love the fact that KT have been able to actually find a draft that works against what might develop as a real meta combination. This Varus Corki, or double AD in general, has been doing a lot of winning recently. As Fixer and Snowflower, just donate gold over to the Annie.
Yeah, that's right. Fixer. Free money. Hit skeletons, free money. It's my motto in life, Papa Smithy.
How's that working out for you?
I need more skeletons so I can get free money.
Look, I'm sure that Thorin will find some of those skeletons.
All right. Well, they're going to back off right there, actually. Mickey taking a lot of damage. Looks like Nagne getting to him just a tiny, tiny bit. I think that the lantern had to be taken first right there from Snowflower.
Awkward, of course, makes Delaney much weaker at level one. If they look for a lane swap, it won't be a big consideration. I guess you could just use it to tank a bit of the Krugs if you do see the Krugs start. But yeah, nice draft on both sides. My issue, I guess, for Anakin, as you have alluded to, is that you kind of only have the explosive cast for disengage. Of course, Snowflower can do some work with the Flay and the box himself, but you need to almost explosive cast two of these threats, otherwise one of them is going to get through.
Well, also the problem is that the Chain of Corruption and the Equalizer are going to have to be used in very weird situations just because KT can attack you from like three angles at once. So there's not going to be a lot of value in the AoE that Anarchy is using in this game, and Fixer just being as annoying as possible right now. He has a W stun. He's going to not take it. Smite used.
Yeah, forces out the smite, at least in the jungle forest. That will decrease the speed on the next camp. So just successfully being super annoying is the Annie.
And that's what you get when you start weak side jungling, Papa Smithy.
It's really become a common thing. I didn't see this much in the LPL, but it seems like in OGN, the greedy start is kind of how I've rationalized it. What is with all these junglers starting the weak side?
I think it's fine if you can actually just go for the buff first and then move on. And to be fair, this was a very conservative weak side jungle start. Like, they were in the camp furthest away, so they weren't going to be disrupted. And it didn't really result in anything either, but just a little bit of annoyance.
I guess maybe the theory there is that usually the support has to go and help with the freeze. So if you're at the further camp, maybe it's going to be slightly later, so safer. But
the theory is that if you just freeze with the AD carry and they happen to be in the lane, you can lose that trade and then start to snowball lose the lane from there, right? Because your AD carry is the one who's very far forward in the freeze and only has that one potion. So that means that the support usually has to stay in lane just to make sure that there isn't somebody going to pop out of a bush and it suddenly becomes a 2v2, right?
And it feels like KT, though, have been the ones to actually win out in the buff trade. They picked up three buffs, Monty, so they're the ones that, I guess, started on the weak side, started on the big buff, didn't get harassed as much, picked up the three buff start, and already Anarchy on the back foot.
Yeah, that's right, and that's what the buff start allows you to do, too, if you're careful with it. It does get you more time. Now they're going to start fast pushing right here. This is very KT. Just go for the fast push right now. Try and deny as much as you can and accelerate the pace of the game.
Just denying out the turrets. They have the advantage of the Sivir, so they have more turret damage compared to the Corki. And Corki's still committed to the freeze. So feels like KT are running this game, and Anarchy are happy to play passive.
And this is the way also that you beat a more amateur team or a less experienced team.
So much clear shot calling needed now.
Yeah, you go through, you play aggressively, you force them to react to you and hope that you have more practiced instincts than they do and that they're going to make a mistake. Anarchy not making any terrible errors yet, not really committing to that top side, which could have been their undoing. Instead, they're going to bounce the wave, so no fast clear on the turret, and instead swap back into a 2v2. So very interesting start here from KT. Did take, like you said, a minor advantage based on that Annie invade early on in the three buff jungle pathing they managed to execute. And now they're hoping that someday is going to be able to make Ixu overextend in the top side and therefore set him up for the gank after the tower bounce.
Something that you've talked about a lot is that Rumble is very likely to overextend when he's looking for trades. Very hard for him not to do damage to the minions, and even though we're talking about a level one flame spitters, it all adds up. It's still 20, 30 damage that will start to push this wave in. You could even see with how the wave was clumped. It's going to slow push towards someday's top lane.
Yeah, Lyra has to recall right now and get his booty up into the top lane so that he's
already in the air.
Yeah, so that they can actually clear this out. He needs to stand inside the lane brush while the push is going on. We'll see how fast he can get up into that side of the map. He is going to drop a ward in there and score too low to make a play at the moment, but he can return after a fountain heal and see what he can do. Score has so many options this game, by the way. We didn't even talk about this.
What lanes to gank for?
Annie, TF with the gold card, and a twisted advance at the top side. This is a jungler's paradise.
A jungler's paradise. Targeted CC, a gangster's paradise almost. but targeted CC in every lane is literally the dream. And he has his own flash instant uncleansable CC himself.
Yeah, very nice setup right now. And also, I mean, I get it's not even who they've got. It's also who they're against. I mean, Varus and Rumble, yes, please.
One Varus and Rumble.
Yes, I would take it as a jungler anytime.
And jungle is your role from memory.
Well, the very rare occasions I play, yes.
Your Vi is legendary, Montecristo.
Play Vi every game. That's my plan.
Acquire Elo?
Yeah, indeed.
Sungyun and Snowfall are both on the back foot, but the CS very, very even in the bot lane. Score, he's got the lanes to gank for, but so far just doing the counter jungling and farming.
Indeed. Well, I'm surprised that he's actually just playing so passively this time around after that little bit of a proxy farm, because he does have a lot of options. Again, we discussed this, but Anarchy coming out with fantastic early wards again.
He's called to bottom lane. Sungyun taking a lot of damage. Might actually die to Sivir, but the flash on Burrow will do it. Fixes super, super low. He might live just. And that's one kill unanswered for KT.
Yeah, that's right. Although it does go onto the jungler. So not the highest priority, but they make it work all the same. Cooldown boots pretty fast here for Nagane, just wanting to spam out cards, keep that lane cleared.
He's losing this lane quite handily. 12 CS is the advantage currently for Mickey. Remember, he's opting into a TS, not buying immediate power, but the base values on that arrow, I believe it adds up to about 400 damage at level 9. You hit that max range arrow, and Twisted Fate, he's gone for boots too, just to try and dodge them, and he's still eating plenty of poke.
Yeah, a bit of a problem right there. We'll see what he can do with the blue buff in addition. Mickey has the wards to just punish him, but Mickey able to play aggressively because, again, look at the warding around the mid lane. There's nothing that they can do. They've got pink wards everywhere right now. Score has very limited gank options.
I feel like someone definitely deserves lots of credit on Anarchy. Maybe it's the whole team, but they understand warding better than most rookie teams I've ever seen.
It's actually quite incredible for them to be this good at it this early on. And this is more like a warding pattern we would see for Faker on SK Telecom than anything else. They know at least their strengths. They know how to play around Mickey and his abilities in this mid lane. And it's all led up to this.
Chains of Corruption hits, but instantly cleansed. Lyra was no real position. Didn't have explosive cask available. So it was optimistic for Mickey. But look, they play around this mid lane player. He's 10 CS up. Not really any downside because the Chains of Corruption, very short cooldown.
And actually right there, it was, I think, a little bit presumptuous to use the cleanse at that time. Not really necessary in any circumstance with the jungler still at level 5. So
for some reason, the word presumptuous used in that particular case made me laugh. How dare you?
Well, that's how I feel about the unnecessary use of summoners, Papa Smithy.
How do you feel about Fizz with Devourer in the jungle?
I am galled.
Galled? Well, look, we're expanding vocabularies, at least, on this cast.
Well, I aim to educate the youth of the world in English. As an English major myself, Papa Smithy, I feel it's my duty.
Well, look, it's a noble endeavor. You don't watch your League of Legends for big words, but we try and sprinkle them in when necessary.
No, you watch me for big words. I'm telling the audience why they watch me right now.
Okay. I've had the same things leveled at me, so between the two of us, we could drop some good ones. You had some excellent words in our last cast. I forget them now. One of them is amazing.
Yes, well, I'm told I'm quite sesquipedalian, so there you go.
You're just making up words now, Monte Cristo. We're waiting to see what happens with good old Someday. We've seen this matchup, twice already today. Of course, Smeb went on to the Riven in the last game. Maokai has consistently been opening up advantages, even though firsthand I've seen lanes where Rumble has run over a Maokai.
Yeah, it does tend to, at least in Korea, go the way of the Maokai, though, especially with that. There's a lot of gold, though, in that early start with the Doran's Ring, so it comes at a price, definitely. For the win, and Mickey again showing some accuracy on that Varus, and Score wants to give him a little room for pause, but Nagne's been bottled up in this mid lane. They have to clear out these wards, so Mickey can't play like he is right now.
And Nagne's had to build suboptimally. He's had to go for boots too. And look, it's always a flexible option, but it's not really the power where you want it with your early 1,000 gold purchase. Now he's very overextended, and Rek'Sai is going to come in.
And there's a blue card lock that's not going to be enough. Someday wants to make a play right here. Snowflower is, of course, there, though, tearing Mickey out of harm's way.
At least that all followed, though. He was playing aggressively, but he had both the jungler in the enemy jungle and Orsusen backing. His son is going to get turret dived.
And there's the stun, into the stun, into the boomerang blade. Ixu is there with an equalizer. Not sure how much that's going to do. Snowflower back on his way down. TB onto Timbers that's tanking the turret. And Ixu is just going to go down right after that. What a wonderful TP from Someday.
Just excellent knowledge. Don't say that enough. And at the same time, it looks like Mickey will get mid turret. That's quite a heavy price to pay for two kills unless they pick up the turret themselves, and they won't. Look, I think it's a pretty even trade because the power
Absolutely.
Of taking out the mid lane turret at, what, 11 minutes into the game? We often see this structure still up 15, 20 minutes into a game.
Yeah, absolutely true. And the fact that they retain their turrets as well, very nice for Anarchy Siege composition. But that said, they're still at a gold deficit in spite of the tower loss, and this is still a composition that is going to run them over in the late game because of their lack of a tank line and the number of ways that KT has to engage. KT gonna bounce back though and actually punish the recalls, look like, with a dragon.
They don't have the ultimate up from Twisted Fate, but he's gonna wave clear and get to the dragon if he needs to. It doesn't even look like it's gonna be called over. It's in perfect vision of Anarchy, but there's no way for them to react. So look, at least they're trying to get something, although Thresh is close. Doesn't quite pick it up.
No, Nagne also threatening on the outside. Fixer's there. Seeing if they can get a pick right here, they're going to walk into a pink ward, and that'll cause the duo lane of Anarchy just to back off.
It's the last time I saw a comp similar to KT's as the Pope already doing a lot of damage from Mickey, but the last time I've seen this sort of comp was actually from Vici Gaming in the LPL. They love to run Lichbane, Twisted Fate, and just split push instantly, and one of the reasons why this is a great game for it, it's a rumble. We already talked about the Riven rumble matchup. Twisted Fate, he's got the instant wave clear. It's pretty hard for the rumble to punish him or even land with the boots 2 to boots 1 advantage, any sort of CC. So if you just split push this Twisted Fate, obviously you can instantly get to other lanes. It empowers the rest of your team to overextend. You should be so confident if you're on this KT lineup that there will be multiple members, because we've got double globals, but, well, triple globals actually. Rek'Sai, Maokai, and Twisted Fate can most of the time instantly react to any sort of skirmish.
Yeah, and this is this composition is very reminiscent of the one that Samsung ran with Bard instead of Annie, actually, with those triple globals and the ability to get to any lane on the map extremely quickly.
Annie makes it scary because, you know, you're split pushing in top, you're split pushing in bottom, Flash Tibbers comes and suddenly it's a 5-man turret dive. They have a lot of flexible options. We already mentioned the fact that it's against a squishy double AD backline, so they have the engage happening there as well. KT have a lot of options, and it's heartening to see them move away from Nunu Ryze, Orianna, kind of like what is going on, to against a very similar comp.
I actually prefer this composition with Bard over Annie because you can engage from the black, from the fog of
Speaking
war.
Speaking of engage.
Oh, here we go. Looks like that's not going to result in anything, though. Chain of Corruption thrown out. Mickey going to take some damage on it on Burrow, but they can't find the follow-up.
They desperately want to blow Mickey's summoner spells, but have not been able to do so.
So I like the Bard better because you can engage from the Fog of War, pop Sivir ult, and then be on top of them by the time that they come out of stasis. And then there's no counterplay to that from a backline like the Varus and the Corki. So it's a fun combination as well, but perhaps Fixer not feeling comfortable on that Bard quite yet.
I feel like the Bard comp has a higher ceiling. I think it can be better, but
yes,
you need to be so confident both as Bard and with Bard. Again, he's one of those champions that warps how you play quite dramatically, and we unfortunately haven't seen any more Samsung Bard because Wraith has hit the lineup over Luna.
And Sweet has been out too, on generic.
All the Bard boys are just in solo queue, obviously practicing their mechanics, and we might see a Riven-like resurgence from the Bard mains.
I hope so.
Fingers crossed. Bard's a cool champion.
He is, and he's great with compositions with TF and Sivir.
It's so great at fighting around Scuttlecrab. You get those stuns through the Scuttlecrab. That's really satisfying when you pull it off.
All right, Mickey still pushing up aggressively. All of his flanks are warded
How
very well.
How little cares does he have at this point? He's so
Zero.
Overextended.
Well, he has no threat either. I mean, you look at this, Snowflower playing back right there. They have so many wards. They can see everyone on both sides of the mid lane, so he's absolutely free to keep punishing Nogne.
I have not seen people solo farming and poking under an inner turret at 15 to 16 minutes into a game, but the pathing from Snowflower, it was the Thresh that got him the MVP. His team is there to relieve pressure and allow him to basically ruin the day for Nogne, to the point where this Twisted Fate side lane ganks, barring one, have been completely absent.
And it's also pinning him there so he can't split push,
yep,
too.
That's the thing. He's stuck with a Lich Bane, doesn't have any sort of mana regen, so obviously has to use blue cards more than he wants, has to balance mana sustain.
Oh, Victor just gets caught and destroyed, drops the Tibbers, but it does nothing. Fixer on a little bit of a face-checking mission there. They knew he was coming. Ward's already there, and that's going to prompt an even harder siege from Anarchy as they're really doing a good job of putting the heat on during their power spike.
They're putting the heat on against a team with three globals. That's the surprising thing, is that I thought KT were going to play the full court press. It's Anarchy just from their smart rotations. And we've said it again, we'll say it again throughout the season, the warding, it's beautiful.
It is, but Ixu has been hung out to dry on this top side. Someday's been increasing that lead and chipping away at the turret, so this won't last forever for Anarchy. They're kind of each team winning different parts of the map at the moment. But
look,
this
Rumble
is
losing is the one champion, yep, you're kind of content with. It's never ideal to have someone losing, but if you're going to leave someone out to dry, it's the person with the lowest item floor, as in the lowest amount of items to be relevant in the team fight. We've always talked about it. Double magic penetration, okay. It's not the backline diving Zhonya's flame spitter Rumble, but it's still a very relevant threat.
Absolutely. Now, KT finally starting to respond with some deep wards of their own.
Spotted out by a ward, though, so.
But they forced them off the tower just for KT's sake to get another tier one, and they're not going to be able to trade very much with this.
They drew
Anarchy.
Twisted Fate to the bottom as well, that they're needing to use maybe one resource too many to make some of these trades super worth.
But it will be worth if they can get the dragon. So
sure.
These wards were put down not only to zone off that tower to get the wave forward, but because the timing around the dragon is really going to be ideal. Someday also going to pick up that farm. And Ixu just having to slowly push up into the top side. So can KT also get a dragon off of this? It's going to be the question. That will make it definitely worthwhile for them. The Righteous Glory complete for Someday right now. They want to push out these lanes one more time and see if they can create a pick, but all those wards they dropped already cleared by Anarchy.
And they have wonderful vision around the dragon area. Mickey has been charging up this Manamun very, very fast, probably gonna be about 23 to 25 minute charge on that one. They're even gonna contest this blue buff. Sign of a top team, get control and push for one resource more.
That's right. Now, Destiny going to go down. Where is he porting? Actually, mid lane. Looks like they just want to get position on that wave, or maybe just needed the vision and then had somewhere to go to get a slight advantage. So that's not going to be around.
And suddenly Mickey is safer and safer. Now he knows there will be not a Twisted Fate in the backline instantly with the Destiny. One less threat. Okay, still KT have Someday and Fixer to potentially get on top of this Varus, but with all his summoners available and the Chains of Corruption, it's just a battle of attrition. They're trying to get punish Anarchy for moving around and kiting downwards onto this mid lane turret, but the turret's still very healthy.
I don't know about leaving Ixu here like this, though. A little bit of a danger. Someday gets caught by a Chain of Corruption straight into a death sentence. Someday still there, pops his ultimate. Snowflower gonna be the first to fall. Arrow gets knocked against the wall by an explosive cast. Nogne with the flash forward onto the gold card, but there's just not enough follow-up. Lyra tries to get onto Nogne, finds himself in the back line. Arrow is there. Arrow is autoing. Arrow gets the kill, but Corki, ooh, is he going to get the cleanup here? Mickey wants the snipe. Score going to take a little bit, but that'll be a 2-for-3 trade in favor of KT Rollster.
One crucial factor, Monte Cristo. Mickey was out of mana for the majority of that fight. There were so many potential snipes, but did not have blue buff, so they were not fighting with really the capability of this Varus to take over a fight to justify the really high amount of items he's already completed. He's even got the armor penetration duo done. Mickey is team fight ready, but he needed the blue to be a real big factor and was kind of ignored during that fight.
And now the timer in terms of this power spike is really on the Zonya's hourglass right now for Nagne. How fast can he get that item? He's so far behind in farm, but once he gets that, Mickey is very unsafe in the back line. So,
Skull gets caught. They're going to get at least a bit of chip damage, though Nagne's there to relieve pressure. Maokai's top lane still has teleport available. They've got a lot of wards. They kind of feel like they have to justify their excellent warding with a dragon, but KT doing everything they can to harangue them out of a five-man push onto dragon.
All right, speed shrine for Anarchy right here. They are well in their power spike with Varus and Corki. Could be dangerous. KT doesn't have to fight this, but they're going to go for it anyway. Fixer once in, hits the W onto Snowflower. Snowflower chunked out once again. Poke coming in from the wild cards. Still a flank threatened from Arrow and from Fixer right here. Poke raining down onto KT Rolster. Now Fixer and Arrow going to rejoin, and that is going to be a dragon score with the smite.
Crucially, 2-0 in dragons. Anarchy were a bit undecided about how aggressive to go. They had all their ultimates available, barring the box from Thresh, but chose to back away. Now they're trying to punish with the rotation, but Twist of Fate will be there and does have good wave push.
Anarchy got really rattled right there. They should never have given up their position on the Scuttle
Crab
like they
did.
They had the speed shrine. They had the poke. All they had to do was use that speed advantage to dodge the poke coming in from KT. Well, getting their own down, they got bullied out for really no reason.
Again, it was just psychological warfare is really the only way we can put it. They had so much vision. Now you can't start to think about how much those wards cost in terms of inventory space and just efficiency of gold. Three pink wards from KT.
Lyra's going to get caught. You can't be there right now. Chain of Corruption goes down, doesn't land onto Arrow. They see everyone with that Destiny.
If ever there was a game to not go on a solo warding mission, it is this one with triple global coming through and even pick CC from Fixer. Just poor play from Lyra. Poor understanding of the comp he's against.
It's still so difficult to play against this if you're Anarchy, though. This is a comp that is custom built to shut you down. So it was an uphill battle from the beginning for Anarchy with this composition. And now, you know, with the two dragons gone, this power spike is waning rapidly. Sangyun actually going for a cutlass before getting those Sork shoes. Not sure about that one. I know he's afraid of someone getting close to him here, but this is a very good situation for KT Rolster to be in.
And it's just delaying the time where Anarchy can just set up and poke under a turret. That's exactly what they're wanting to do, but we already mentioned it's very difficult to do against this comp. Arrow is a bit lazy with his recoil. He's going to die for free. He thought he was in a position where he wasn't going to be spotted, but the answer was that he certainly was.
Yeah, very sloppy from Arrow.
He was shopping, you could see.
Yep. Otherwise, he would have hit that spell shield. Pretty easy block onto Snowflower's Q. And instead, not respecting that warding, and that's something that everyone has to really get a read on. Now, there's not really anything that Anarchy can do off of that. All the waves weren't in their favor. Can't take a dragon. So the pick kind of meaningless in the long run, particularly when KT has such a strong objective advantage right now. And considering that Anarchy has already fallen behind on turrets, when they're the one running the siege mid-game siege comp is a very bad sign.
Yeah, both turrets and dragons working against them. Crucial two dragons already completed by KT, and that's after the prepping. The ward play, as we talked about, has been on point. To then lose the dragon is super awkward for this Anarchy mid-game comp. Look, it's definitely not a bridge too far. They're going to pick up the answering turret at this point. They have excellent itemization onto their carries. It's just, how do you keep them safe against all the backline threat?
And Nagne, how scary is he going to be with that Zonya's Hourglass where he can actually provide the primary engage? He can come in from an opposite flank from Someday and force the burn of an Equalizer or an Explosive Cask in a very ineffective manner, or less than ideal.
And what Twist of Fate does with Zonya's is it just makes your positioning that more on point. You can be so aggressive. If you have him, you can have Maokai push with Reckless Abandon top. Twist of Fate has popped the ultimate. He's going to go for the flank.
Wow, look at that. Finds Mickey on the side. Combos him to 50%. Arrow with the flash forward. Killed by Score, actually. And Lyra finds himself isolated and also a corpse.
Yeah, that's what we expect to happen, a preview of future fights. I think he had cleanse available, crucially used the flash and not the cleanse, which Don't know how much that will help him in the next fight to not have to reposition as well. No opportunity to go into any sort of untargetability, and this could be another further turret dive.
You can really see how scared Anarchy's getting, and oh my, goodbye. Oh, Song Yun actually living for a while right there. Gets out with the help of a flash, but Iksu not going to be quite so fortunate. There's the Unburrow. There is the kill. Snowflower going to be chased down all the way to his inhibitor. Goodbye.
Really poor target selection. It doesn't even matter because it's a 5v3 scenario. They could have picked up a perfect ace in that particular situation. Song Yun somehow survived. Someone got bored, decided not to auto-attack him anymore. They get the objective that's far more important to them. And the reality of this game, Monty, is that as this game goes on, Twisted Fate going to overextend, Malka going to overextend, even the jungle camps are going to be a bridge too far for Anarchy to pick up, and this gold is going to get massive. He's going to see the replay coming in. Just watch Twisted Fate goes for a very good flank to the back line. Nothing Mickey can do and dies instantly.
I love the decisiveness of Arrow with the flash and the ult right there as well. They know they have Mickey isolated. If he dies, everything comes unraveled in terms of their ability to withstand the siege as well. So they just set up again. Score going to go through, take the Raptors right here. Song Yun gets out with a flash, but look at this setup from Fixer.
Waiting for the go button.
They see everyone with the Tremor Sense as well, and so that's just going to be a flash. Song Yun somehow stays alive through this, gets unburrowed on, and just lives with the heal and the flash off the back. And now Iksu going to go down as well. Arrow mopping up kills left and right with his auto attacks, just running all the way through and taking a turret and now another turret for their trouble.
Every time the Destiny is available, you don't know whether it's a bait when they're pushing in so aggressively onto structures. That's the fourth turret of the game, and TF having free time in bot.
And what I wanted to say, too, about how in the heads of Anarchy KT are right now is when that Destiny went up that killed Mickey in the last fight, Snowflower flashed immediately. He was so scared of the Destiny going down. As soon as the TF ult come up, he flashes. That's a big waste of a summoner cooldown right there that I don't think was really necessary.
With the power of picking up maybe three dragons and some turret advantage themselves, unfortunately KT are the team that have been able to do that, even with their late game scaling. Lyra's going for an emergency, misses the explosive cast, the Rumble Equalizer burns down, Fix is dead, Anarchy, they get two kills, and Mickey's still alive.
But the backline cavalry is here, Nagne going to, actually Zhonya's out right now, he will be focused down. Some days, the last man standing in an epic 1v3 that he's going to win, it would appear. Iksu getting low, Iksu twisted advance, Iksu gets hit by the arcade smash, and will the sapling be enough? He's slowed, he's twisted advance, now it's time for Lyra. Tank Wars someday wins.
But so much closer. Remember, there was about an 8,000 gold lead coming through before that fight for KT. But the difference between two fights, Mickey and Song Yun both live. Specifically, Mickey did a lot of damage that fight. He has all the armor penetration. He's even got the Yomu's Ghost Blade, which is becoming a core on Varus. You pop that Ghost Blade, pick up the first kill, suddenly you get 6 seconds of power because that's how Varus' passive works, and still have quite a lot of auto attack damage to go and supplement your poke. So a much closer team fight, but how many of more of those can Anarchy engineer?
KT also decided to fight that in a choke with an equalizer and a bunch of pokes, so there's that aspect coming into it as well.
Don't bring your facts to this discussion, Monte Cristo. It's now a super close game.
It is not. I reject your hypothesis, sir. But yeah, that fight was about as ideal as it could have gotten in terms of terrain use for Anarchy as well, so probably not going to get a good one like that unless KT really can't figure it out. Not going to take red buff.
You know.
He doesn't even care if there's a ward there.
Have many cares. Lyra, nope.
Oh, wow. Actually used the smite right there. Has to explosive cast. Still gets hit by the Timbers. Wild cards on his head. And there is a chilling smite. Can they finish it off? The answer is yes. Score steals the kill for no reason.
Now they're ever present across the map. This is all without Sivir Group. Just going to push down the mid. Another outer turret will fall. Only one going to be left on the map after picking up this objective. And someday, you can tell by his health bar that he's pretty tanky.
He's even going to go in right there. Equalizer down, Chain of Corruption down. There's not going to be follow-up thanks to the Varus ultimate. And there's the Righteous Glory pop. KT starting to back off this one. Arrow has to flash out of the Flame Spitter. but not before he picks up a kill on Desangyun. Two defenders remaining. That'll be enough considering the low HP bars for KT to pack their bags and head home.
So much gold in the bank. Rek'Sai, 2,000 plus gold. Sivir, 2,000 plus gold. Going for the Bloodthirster. No rush to pick up any sort of armor penetration because it's literally no armor on the side of Anarchy.
Yeah, that is a, that's a bad situation to be in where the Sivir can just rebuild a Bloodthirster and Infinity Edge.
And still cutler everyone like butter.
It's not good.
No.
Well, I really like the comp we're seeing coming out of KT this game. I think they learned from their mistakes from the Ku Tigers. But can you fault Anarchy for just a couple days after that match, thinking that they could maybe try the same tactic?
Archer's Glory used again back away. No, I don't. I think you go for it, but it's kind of heartening if you're a KT fan to say, look, they obviously reviewed the VOD, they talked with the analysts, now they're more equipped to deal with double AD that a lot of teams are defaulting to. It's not Varus Vayne, it's Varus Corki, which I personally prefer more. You have that mixed damage poke that's so hard to deal with. Snowfire finds five members, but somehow lives.
Yeah, they weren't actually particularly decisive on that engage right there. I really think KT could have gone for it, but they're also setting up, they're developing their split push right now. Nagne on the side, doing a lot of work. So there's not really a rush for KT. Look at their vision on the top side as well. They have 100% control over the Baron Pit. They have a great split push. They're going to get something regardless of what happens.
And it's a risk to pick up your Raptors. It's a risk to actually go and fight for the walls if you're Anarchy because of these globals, like we mentioned, because of all the advanced wards that KT have been able to push up. It's one of those games where eventually you keep pushing up waves until there's just been more than 3 minutes since Anarchy have even had a chance to put down a ward around Baron, and there should be one of these Barons that's almost uncontestable for Anarchy. And that should be just maybe the last window into the game for Anarchy closed and KT to round it out.
Absolutely. Well, they could do this Baron really at any time right now. They could force a face check at any time. KT actually maybe playing too far up on these lanes in terms of the split pushing. And they are really going for the full vision denial right here. I mean, they could do this. There's the stun, and Snowflower gets caught. Gold card will lock him up.
Rek'Sai's just walking into the back
line. Here we go. Are we going to see that Destiny? Yes, we will. Oh, goodbye, though, to Nagne before he can use the Zhonya's Hourglass. Now they're still moving forward. Great stun, and that'll be a cleanup probably onto Iksu. He's on top of Arrow, but Arrow going to get the fadeaway Boomerang Blade for the kill.
Yeah, Sungyun actually going to get aggressed onto. Someday goes back and goes for the turret dive. Tanks a lot of turret shots, so probably going to fall, though. He's Maokai, super tanky. High base burst lives and takes down the AD carry. Now fighting against Lyra, gets another passive prop. Someday's going to live.
And he is. Arrow actually forcing the flash onto Lyra right there. We've seen two really good Maokai fights tonight, one from Smeb, one from Someday now, playing on the brink, using that auto attack to get up, but KT still taking some lumps right there as the Foss Bomb combo just annihilated Nagne before he could hit his Zhonya's.
Speaking of annihilation, don't know if Thresh has the damage, has Ignite up, really wants Arrow to step through one of these walls, doesn't do it. You know, it's probably a bad point in the game when you try and duel the enemy Sivir who has Infinity Edge Bloodthirster,
it's really,
Static Shift.
It's really the Bloodthirster. When you see that, you should know you can't actually duel her anymore if you're a Thresh.
Probably would have meant more stream viewers if you've been able to pick up that solo kill. So maybe not the worst reason to go for that one. It's going to be the fourth dragon, so didn't think KT needed another win condition, but add that one to the list.
Yeah, they want everything in this game, Papa. Just take it all up while they can. Why the hell not?
Anarchy, to their credit, have played well. It's just, I feel like the champion select, I wouldn't even say let them down. I just feel like KT have done everything right. They've picked well. They've played around things well. Some days unkillable, and just no one can make him accountable. Now that he's finished the Thorn Mail, it's just a disgusting amount of armor. And this is the Baron that's been prepped for the last, what, 7 minutes of the game? There's never been a chance to get wards around. Scrying Orb comes through. Snowflower's doing his best, but how do you get anywhere near with all this
Pixie
Z? Oh,
Zhonya needs a gold card to start the fight. Bad Equalizer, not going to do much of anything at all. Iksu going to pay with his life for that. And now just an attempt at a disengage, but Someday's not done yet. Just moving through the enemy team. Arrow on cleanup duty. Arrow going to get the triple kill. Nagne, Snowflower, quadra kill. Can they get the pentakill? There's the stop. Lyra, is he going to go down to Arrow? Another pentakill
tonight. Double pentakill!
So good. Great job from KT to prep that one. Two pentakills in back-to-back games. One for Smebs Riven, one for Arrows Sivir, and that's going to be the end of the game.
The best exclamation mark to end what has been an entertaining game. They don't have the minions and the people going to respawn to, but there's the surrender. KT rolls still. We wondered if they bounced back from what was a poor series. They just snuck over against IM and then objectively poor against the Ku Tigers. This is the KT Rollster that kind of led the way at the start of the season. They're just definitely picking up. And crucially, their original strength, the pick bands, much more on top of those this game.
Absolutely. And at the end of that, Arrow ends 15-2-10. That is the biggest kill performance we've had by any single player this season so far. 15 kills, putting him way, way up there. But for me, I mean, Someday was just really the backbone of that series. 7-1-16 on the Maokai.
Yeah, 23 out of 28 kill participation from the Maokai, amazingly, is actually lower than the 20.
What happened in the last match between Ku and KT Rollster? And there is going to be a Varus ban. Unsurprisingly, can't counterpick it now.
And I feel like the Sivir ban has to follow, Monty. I feel like KT are really empowered by that Sivir. They really play around the movement speed and the backline threat that it often provides you super, super well. Can they fit in on the red side a Sivir ban? Sivir, Kalista, lots of priority picks available so far.
Also, KT not a team that really prioritizes junglers, because Score is actually very diverse in terms of his champion picks, and he often takes a back seat in terms of priority to a lot of other members of the team. Would they first pick Alistar? Maybe. Will they first pick Score? Yes, absolutely they will. First pick Sivir, excuse me, yeah.
And Alistar in general has proved to be, basically everyone who's playing him has very high win rates in that champion. It has been a cornerstone of winning comps in champions so far this season, so they might feel pressured if they have to live up the Alistar, but personally, if I had to choose between the two, I'd rather give them the Alistar than the Sivir.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you, but they're going to have to choose whether they want to give up the Kalista as well, still unbanned, and the Thresh, no surprise from KT. Snowflower doing some good work on that champion once again.
So there's a lot of champions to ban on the red side. It's one of those situations where they could just maybe ban something off to the side like an Azir and just pick up two strong champions, or are they just really concerned about a champion like the Kalista, like the Sivir? To me, the Sivir stands out, but at least you'll get one of those champions as the answer, and they go with the Annie. Okay, slightly more safety for the backline now that the Annie is removed from the champion pool.
And there it is, Alistar for KT, prioritizing that. Again, like Sivir, though, a champion that you can dive early on with because of his ultimate. His ult is probably something that really needs to be looked at in terms of balance, because that's the reason why he's picked so much right now. The ult combined with his CC, because his tankiness as a support in the mid game is unparalleled, and his disruption capabilities, so really versatile.
If I was on the balance team, if I was looking at his ultimate, maybe I'd make it do reduce damage from all sources except turrets, because his turret damage tanking is just, it's obscene. It's one of those situations where if you run a split push comp against an Alistar and you try to pull off, say, a 3v4 hold, he'll just flash pulverize you, activate his ultimate, and tank for days. So that's kind of the thing, is he equalizes sieges. He's so strong at turret diving.
And
it's a big nerf, but...
And at preventing turret dives, too.
Yep, both ways. So.
You can see why he's so potent. Kalista has to be taken here by Anarchy, lest they give up a Kalista Alistar lane to KT Rollster, and they're going to grab the Gragas once again.
So maybe we'll see a disengage comp around Sungyu. That hasn't really been an identity that we've seen too much from Anarchy, especially not too much winning on that particular comp, as it usually takes away from Mickey playing that big threat in the mid lane. Sivir Alistar is a possibility. Sivir Alistar Vlad could be a wonderful combination. There's no rush to pick up the Sivir, because of course we're not expecting that to be picked up by Anarchy now that they already have the Kalista. KT can go wherever they want. Obviously, Alistar, the ultimately flexible first pick.
And KT is a team that lets the Kalista through. They're one of the teams that's most comfortable in playing against it. They may play Urgot Braum. That has been an answer before. The Victor dropped all the way through picks and bans last game, surprisingly. Now, the Ahri is still available, which could be a threat to the Victor, and definitely something Mickey likes to play.
Speculated that perhaps the ban strategy from the Anarchy on the blue side was around getting Victor, because of course they banned LeBlanc and a lot of other priority champions. In the end, they didn't select the victor. They went double AD, so still kind of followed that you want to give remove the assassination threat. But now we see Victor locked in on the blue side. Just a lot of power already put together by KT.
Yeah, Score looking to reprise his Rek'Sai performance from the last game as well, which certainly was very good, hitting a lot of the secondary engages and knockups, following Someday in. Someday still with the ability to play that Maokai in the top side once again. Mickey with the hover over the Ahri right here. That would be the expected pickup.
Ahri hasn't been too convincing so far in Champions. There's definitely been some winning on that Champions. Faker, even of all people. Didn't really feel like Ahri was the cornerstone to their victory they picked up with that particular champion, but it's a good lane matchup, especially on paper, and in the past has been one of the strongest opportunities to go against Victor. And again, you're getting Mickey on a champion that can make plays, that can make picks, that can take over games. So far it's the Ahri, and they lock in the cannon. Now that could definitely be a support cannon.
Absolutely.
This is something that Zero has loved to do. They love it. When previously on Starhorn Royal Club, now on King, they love the Kalista cannon combination.
Right.
Great for initiation, but also for peel. Because again, just activate that Slicing Maelstrom. How do you get through Gragas ultimate and just the AoE stun of the Slicing Maelstrom?
Yeah, still a bit of anti-synergy though between the Explosive Cask and the Kennedy.
Defensively though?
Defensively it's fine. But you need some form of engage here. And of course, the Kalista Cannon really coming SK Telecom's invention. So it's been played a lot in Korea as well, though we haven't seen it for quite some time. But running one of these resourceless champions as a support really does allow you a lot of harass. There's a lot of kill pressure.
Lane presence in general from Cannon, super, super high. High base values. A lot of threat of CC, basically, in both lane and in terms of team fights. I think they're going to kite backwards, this Anarchy lineup, so I think you need the hard engage. And it looks to be an Ixu special, a CV Max special. Both of those, Anarchy have loved the Hecarim, but it's going to be KT to pick it up.
And I love the Hecarim pickup here. Like you said, they've got Alistar, Hecarim, follow-up from Rek'Sai. They have the tools necessary to really get onto Anarchy and deal with them. Question is, are they going to go for an exhaust for the Ahri or not? And you know something about the Victor-Ahri matchup is that if you play with that Lichbane Victor, you can actually trade pretty effectively if the Ahri comes into range, because you know she's going to be coming in with the Spirit Rush. And that speed boost that you can get and the really hard hit, it's a punishing tactic against an Ahri who wants to all in you.
And Ahri needs to get chip damage before she can realistically do that, especially because he's going for the very defensive summoner in Cleanse. The thing about harassing a Victor as Ahri is that you're often quite predictable when you're going up for your Q harass. And if Victor can get down those death ray trades, it's going to be fairly even. So solo kill pressure is certainly not inevitable for the Ahri. You need to significantly outplay your opponent. And Nagne is no slouch on this Victor. So a very nice turret-taking comp as well coming through from KT. Throw down the gravity field, Trinity Force Cork. You can take down those structures. A lot to like about KT. Anarchy, for me, if you get the control over objectives, you're fighting at Dragon, the kite back of this comp and damage you can do with so much peel for the Kalista, the Ren sets are a possibility. But if they have to go in aggressively, as you mentioned, anti-synergy between their lockdown is clear.
I'm just worried about Anarchy's lack of damage with this composition. There's not a lot of consistent damage to be done right here when you compare it to the Victor on the side of KT. KT also balancing out their AP damage with that top lane Hecarim. So Anarchy here, I feel that you get a little MR against them, and you already have the tools to lock down the Kalista, and they're in big trouble.
Stack MR, kill the AD carry. It's certainly been a common strategy, and I can't really disagree with you here. As you mentioned, Ahri mostly about burst, Maokai, good base, magic damage values. How safe are you as the Kalista in this particular game? Hecarim's flanks, very hard to stop. Alistar, as you mentioned, also going to be a very strong backline threat, even with Kennen, Gragas, and Maokai. It's still not 100% they'll be able to peel every fight for this Kalista to do damage.
Yeah, indeed. Well, interesting times here. Can KT do well versus Anarchy for the second game in a row? Or can Anarchy make this an even series with Mickey's Ahri to get into the game? right.
Everyone in good voice here for our second game, potentially the last game of the night. It's already our fifth game. A snowflower is glowing. Is that a halo?
He is. He's got a halo. Interesting. So coming off with Song Yun right there, showing the...
It's because he's so short. It looks hilarious, right? It looked like it was around his head rather than just the standard Callisto.
The oath bind or whatever it is. That's what happens. Kennen becomes holy when with Callisto. It's a bloody halo, so we'll go with unholy instead.
An unholy chipmunk. Not among my favorite things.
No one has been able to satisfactorily answer my question as to why some Yordles are furry and some are not. Because people keep trying to tell me, well, some of the Yordles are furry because they're male and the hairless ones are female, but explain Corki then. You can't.
I'm going to go back and consult some of Riot's lore and get back to you on the specifics. I'm sure it's written in one of the passages.
I would never wish that on my worst enemy, Papa Smithy, so please don't do that. I'd like to keep you somewhat sane for our future broadcasts. Reading that is like staring into the abyss.
Look, Riot have
assured us. Look what happened to Doa when he did it.
It's true. He's never been the same. Look, Riot have assured us that the lore will see a rework. Hopefully that will be one of the many burning questions answered. Why are some Yordles furry?
I do enjoy that people are like, well, it's the male ones. I'm like, no, it's not. You can't explain that.
Is Tristana furry?
Magnets. How do they work?
Yordles. How do they work? I can't get beyond this halo. I'm really distracted by it. I would like to see another lane, please. There's going to be a lot of lane pressure from the cannon. Obviously, the ranged auto attack. Going to keep auto attacking the Alistar. He's gone for the Spell Thief, so obviously going to get plenty of damage from there. It's plenty of gold, actually. Just going to basically get it whenever he wants it. Level 2 hit by both teams.
Very annoying level 2, though. Getting the stun onto Arrow. Very favorable trade for Anarchy, even with the sustain from the Alistar in the laning phase. KT going to have to play back on this lane for just a little bit. But the Alistar, honestly, a great tool against the Kennen. He's going to be able to punt Kennen out if Kennen tries to go in with the Slicing Maelstrom later in the game. And that's probably going to make it very ineffective unless, like you said, it's going to be used as a counter-engage tool rather than a secondary engage tool.
That's probably the only boon that Anarchy have to show is that if you had a top lane Kennen, you basically get hard countered by this Alistar. Now we're seeing some nice pathing come through, so Mickey could be in a lot of trouble. Score's going to show up behind. Flash on Burrow comes in. Is there enough damage? It's looking like the answer's yes. Score picks up the kill credit, and KT, they get rolling at 3.5 minutes.
Yeah, Nagne wanted to actually get another spell down there, but he had just used his ability, so rather than wait out the cooldown, Score goes for the killing blow.
Death Ray is about 14 second cooldown
at
level
long,
one. So
very, very long.
He just didn't have the real potential. Nagne probably could have flashed for some autos, but just wasn't really worth it. Would then be kind of defenseless against an Ahri with Ignite when it came to level 6. So probably the smart move. And Rek'Sai, she can probably parlay that into maybe some more turret diving if she gets the Cinderhulk very early.
Yeah, we'll see what Score can do. Definitely some nice pathing there to start out this game. Good trade going on. There's a Gragas, though. Snowflower getting very low. Are they going to pursue this? No, KT doesn't know where Lyra is. Lyra coming in right now. Vixer has to flash. There's a knockback and the kill. Lyra picking it up with an auto attack. Songyun and Snowflower taking the brunt. And man, Lyra had nearly finished his recall right there. But a heads-up play keeps him on the map and probably saves Snowflower's life.
Yeah, probably good calling to get him into the bottom. I don't know if that was a reaction or whether it was a proactive call by Snowflower. It looked like he'd taken a trade too far and was going to fall down, but did live, so equalizes some of the global gold. But KT, 500 gold ahead, just looking down. That's mostly in the CS, and Hecarim actually really outmatching Iksu in the early game.
Yeah, indeed. Well, Someday has been showing his lane dominance. And, you know, Someday is a player that when he falls behind, he frequently has bad games. But I don't know if there is a more punishing top laner in Korea. Score actually gets caught out a little bit right here. Fixer's just going to turn that one around, even though Nagne gets charmed. As I was saying, I'm not sure there is as punishing a top laner in Korea, where if this guy gets a lead on you, he just chokes the life out of you so easily. We've seen him. That's why he has all of these MVP points right now, is because when he gets a lead, it there's no coming back, really.
Despite his 10-8, he has been around the scene for a very, very long time. I believe he was, 16 when he first
15.
Started playing? 15 when he was first playing competitive play for, was it the Arrows or the Bullets?
Well, it would have been A or B back in the day, actually.
I think it was might have been A and then moved to B.
He's been on both teams several times, which is why I'm having trouble remembering where he actually
have
started.
I stumped you on an OGN question, Monte Cristo?
Well, he's been on, like I said, he's been on both teams on multiple occasions, so it is, I think he may have started on B, actually, but...
Speaking of Sunday, taking a lot of damage. Is he going to win this trade? He does! Wow!
And that's going to be his death at the end. Lyra gets another kill and is going to freeze the lane right there.
That wasn't in the spirit of Oktoberfest at all.
What, killing?
Well, I mean, it just kind of was. It's a bit distraction as Mickey almost dies in the mid lane, has to use the Spirit Rush defensively.
Are you telling me? I mean, the spirit of Oktoberfest.
Look, rabble rousing, fighting, sure, but murder?
Well, just depends on your ethics, because it was a harvest festival in October.
Uh-huh.
So unless, I mean, animals, plants, you're murdering those for the harvest. Come on, Papa.
He killed a horse, so that's probably okay. I think it checks out. The law checks out. I give you a pass on that one.
Excellent.
Cannon gets headbutted over a ledge. Probably going to see plenty of that headbutt action. Just bringing back to the original point. Very good against the AP Cannon because it's going to be kiting backwards. Maybe not going to be as much of a boon for the Alistar. During all this time, scoring Someday, easily taking down this dragon. Someday still has teleport, so can use it defensively. Of course, it'll be on a very similar timer. Dragon down to 400. Now they have two smites, so surely one of them can get the work done.
And Someday gets the work done indeed. Nagne caught out, has to flash. TP coming in onto a gravity field. Kind of awkward. Can Nagne actually get out of this, though? Ooh, he's getting within Twisted Advantage. Gonna get slowed, poked, and there he goes. They trade at least one kill. Anarchy wants to dive this Fixer. Now a corpse.
Two
next
kills
to a turret.
For a dragon and the use of teleport. So maybe Someday can make it worthwhile that he still has teleport available. If they take down this bottom lane turret, that's a big objective win.
I don't think they can. No, they have to back off. There's no damage yet. I mean, look at Sung Yun's build. He has a dagger.
That's, you know, more of the...
Score looking for a play right here. TP from Someday coming in right now. There's a double knockup. Smite goes down. No red buff secured. Someday comes in to massacre his enemies. No ult for him to go over the wall yet. Score slides into the Baron Pit, or Dragon Pit, rather.
And 2-for-1 and a dragon. Just about worth for KT, but still very precariously closed. It can't pick up the next kill, but looked like they're going to be contesting this blue buff. Ahri needs the blue, especially if Victor picks one up. She's not going to have a lot of lane control, and if Victor can just free push and back away and have no real kill pressure from Mickey, negates a lot of the value of the pick.
Yeah, it definitely does, and look at this, KT
going
to hand it over to Nagne. So a blue buff definitely advantage KT's now as the dust settles. Now Someday, of course, didn't have to use his TP. He just walked after the kill down to the dragon in the hopes of getting that objective. He does. Good map movement from Someday this game. Sacrificed a little bit of his CS lead for it, but he's going to be probably pretty okay with that. Interestingly, Home Guards, no Skirmisher's Saber yet.
No, not even, I guess the machete is no real point to buy that unless you're going to buy the whole Skirmisher's Saber.
Yeah.
But yeah, just going for combat stats. So respecting the base values on Maokai's abilities, Home Guard's obviously impact on the map. Anarchy are trying to pick up a steal as well, but it doesn't look like Mickey will be able to pick it up. And the result is still a blue buff deficiency for the Ahri in mid lane.
Yeah, they get some good wards down, though. They will have some knowledge about whether or not Someday's going to be getting more ganks in this top side. Lear is going to show up on this one. Someday will gallop to safety.
Actually, only just got his ultimate at the tail end of that engage, so maybe there was a slight window for a kill, but a bridge too far as Anarchy's aware.
Yeah, lots of wards, though. They know where Score is. Moving up to that side of the map right now. They want to punish Ixu even more. Ixu actually did get a kill in that engage, so he's not as far behind as he once was. Has some of that armor to keep the Hecarim at arm's length.
Anarchy are going all in on the early game team fights. You can see that was a working towards the Hurricane Rush as far as we can tell.
That almost never happens in Korea, too.
There's a small chance that I guess it could be Blade of the Ruined King given the changes to the build path with Berserker Greaves, but I mean, just as an analyst, you have to think it's going to be the Hurricane. They have a lot of peel, especially if the home guard teleport doesn't come through onto the Kalista, but it's a really all or nothing build coming through from Sungyoon.
Yeah, I'm generally not a fan of this build because it really requires you to be able to hit multiple targets at the same time, and getting in close enough to a victor can be a dangerous prospect, where considering that you're already probably going to be zoned out by a gravity field and an Alistar, there's not a high probability that you're going to hit those multiple targets, and instead the Bloodthirsts are much more safe for single target damage and then leaping through a team fight, killing one person at a time.
And obviously he's not locked into just finishing the Hurricane. Maybe it was just a case of having 1,000 gold and thinking, okay, I need to get something, so built the recurve bow just for a bit of lane presence. Lack of a BF, so it's going to be super, super auto. Even when it comes to controlling wave, doesn't have too many options at the bottom. We see the Fate's Call used. Vix is still level 5. Has his flash of over. Will get out, or will he not? Snowfire's taking a lot of damage himself. Will he fall down? He's on one hit away. And wow, lots of resources used and nothing picked up for either team.
Yeah, two summoners and now scores here as well. Nearly gets the kill with the Preyseeker. Nagne on the roam. But Anarchy backing off. And that'll save the turret in the bottom side as well. Very nicely played defensively by KT Rolster on that clever little engage by Lyra.
Hexu as a Hecarim main might look at the scoreboard and really understand that being 25 CS behind a Hecarim is already going to be a big handful in the late game, but a Hecarim with Smite who hasn't even taken any semblance of laning Summoner, it's a bit of a strategic hole that KT are probably going to be able to exploit. He's the one that's going to be anointed to get on the Kalista in fights, and Kalista going for this more Renset build as far as we can see, or at least having a very delayed two-item power spike between the Bloodthirster and the Hurricane, should be singled out by an overly farmed 2-1-0 someday.
Yeah, they're trying to go for Mickey again. They do force the use of Spirit Rush, and he'll just dodge out of the way of a Death Ray afterwards, but that's a lot less threatened. There's the Hurricane, so mystery solved. Sungyoon going Hurricane Burst. Does have good wave clear, at least.
And look, he'll show up at a team fight in 25 seconds. No armor built by Someday, no armor in general. If they don't respect the power spike, there is that potential for a big Renset-centric fight, but it's a lot. It's a very all-in play for 13 minutes. It's a very all-in play for an AD carry in general.
Yeah, and that's why I just see it as carrying so much risk here in general. Not even just here, but in almost any circumstance that you could play Kalista in. And that's it's more dice roll nature is why we don't see it really in Korea, the land of the high probability for play.
So look, it was popular in China, and I feel like one of the reasons that it kind of fell away is that if you're in a scenario like this where score's been sent around the map where jungle pressure's fairly even, it only gives you one option. You can only push with this item. You're naturally going to push the wave, even though you don't have a high AD value. You're going to push the wave into KT, and then they have the options. Do they start the freeze? Do they try and counter push? Do they just position their jungler to be there when you inevitably push the lane? There's a lot of options to counterplay against a Hurricane Rush.
And the advantage to the Hurricane is that pushing power where you can open up the early dragon. Of course, you already have that natural ability to get the dragon very quickly with Kalista, but you have to make plays on the dragon in that case, and that's what they're doing. Score is already there, though. Lyra isolated on the side, has to body slam over the wall, but starts tangling with blue buff. Smooth transition there, Lyra.
Exactly, just helped with the leash. Score doing a bit of damage as well. Maybe Mickey will finally pick up his first blue of the game. He does, but Someday's using this time to push aggressively. 22 CS is the advantage in top lane. They're getting a lot of chip damage onto this turret as well.
Really bad time to do that blue buff, actually.
Well, I mean, to be fair, it's not like they chose that time. The blue buff literally chose them, Monte Cristo.
Lyra trying to look smooth, just body slamming. I just wanted to be here all along. This is my goal.
Honestly, it does give them the lowered cooldown, because of course if you collide with a minion, you get half off the cooldown. So look, it wasn't the worst scenario in the end. When this happens, though.
I'm not sure I agree with you, Bob Smithy.
To blue or not to blue? That is the question.
Well, the answer is no. Do not do it. Someday, just going to casually catch the top wave here, get all that CS, has his TP if it's necessary, has his Cinder Hulk completed.
map. It seems a lot of blue and red pings around the jungle of KT. Flash into the charm, flashed away.
Ixu taking a lot of damage right there, though. Trying to follow up. Nope. Not going to hit the Orb of Deception. Maokai really hurting after that one.
And Someday gets a lot of free time. Just free hit onto this turret. We'll be able to take the turret and engage. Now, probably won't be able to go back and get the home guards, but with Ixu backing away, would even be able to use the home guard engage if he so chose to. So KT get everything they want and continue to set up for this dragon.
Yeah, they do. So big turret kill in the top side. More and more gold for Someday. And this is what I mean. He's starting to pull away in this game. 40 CS up, gets the isolation gold from the turret. And now he's going to take your red buff.
He even has a smite to secure it. So level 11 smite versus potentially level 8. If he shows up at a dragon, it's almost certainly going to be a second dragon of the game for KT. So able to back away, now has so many options. The Cinderhulk completed, as you mentioned.
He's going to have a lot more than that. Now with the cowl as well, not at all worried about this Kalista. And if Anarchy wants to get this, the way they get it is by stacking a million Kalista Spears into it right now, so there can't be a possibility of a dragon contest. But they have to get started on it first.
Obviously, with the high amount of speed, high amount of spears due to the attack speed, they do have quite good dragon secure of their own, but they're very, very scared about playing around this objective. This kind of conservative play cost them in the previous series, where they could have been more aggressive around objectives. At this point, though, they've got a lot of these spears down, and they secure it.
KT trying to rocket their way to victory. They're happy, though. They got
Ixu's actually in a lot of trouble. Red buff, and now half health. Still has ultimate here Someday. We're going to need to see some semblance and outplay from Ixu.
Dead.
He wants to get under the turret. What can he do? This is not Someday's Maokai from the previous game. And Nagne even comes and accepts the gratification of a gift.
Oh, tribute for Nagne in the top lane. Thank you, Someday.
Sometimes it's just easy to be a mid laner.
Ooh, Vixer right there, tries for the all-in, backfires a little bit, he gets out thanks to his ultimate there, but there's no follow-up score, just making sure that there isn't going to be any kind of turnaround as the Alistar ultimate wears off.
The burst trades from a Trinity Force Cocky just pale in comparison to the hurricane damage coming through from Kalista. Kennen basically below half health with just the Phosphorus Bomb auto that came through from Aris. They have to be very careful with the trades. Well, in that particular case, score was already there, so didn't bite the bait. Spirit Rush is used. They want to get onto Nana. There's no chance he has the damage, but Lyra's there as well. Actually picks up the trade kill. Isn't going to be able to get out as far as we can see. Nope.
Nagne so thoroughly outplayed Mickey right there. They had so many wards in the river, and they knew that Mickey was going down. We see that Nagne had already finished the Merc Treads and the Abyssal. He had the tools in order to win a duel, so he sort of baited him into it right there. Unfortunately for him, Lyra was there, but that's one of those, I mean, we don't see a lot of times. Nagne's a very solid, very consistent mid laner where Nagne takes that kind of risk, where he wants to get that big outplay. Well, we see it right there.
And the moment that a Spirit Rush charge was used, it just looked like there wouldn't be enough damage for Ahri to take him down. It's like when Riven has to use the Broken Wings to get into range, so a lot bitten off for what ended up being an unadvantageous trade, because of course they used the jungler's time in that particular engage just to get a trade kill.
Yep, indeed. So KT stacking up the kills, stacking up the advantages across the map right now. They took out the bottom tier one thanks to Arrow's Trinity Force, and at 3-0 in terms of turrets comprising that gold lead for KT, except we'll see what happens at this next dragon. They are in a very good position to do that. Someday is just so far ahead in the top side.
He doesn't quite have his Warden's Mail, but most likely building towards the Frozen Heart, not rushing for damage because he has plenty of damage coming through from both Arrow and Nagne this part of the game. Even contesting buffs like the Krugs, and that lets you know that KT are well on top of this game.
Yep. Well, Nagne here with Someday, serving a zoning purpose in that mid lane. Nagne going to try and poke Mickey as he returns. Ixu, not in too much threat from the top side right now with Mickey there to back him up. But they do get chased around their own jungle a little bit. So much control in the top side of the map from KT Rolster.
in the minion wave. Not necessarily pushing out in top, so no big side wave advantages as far as we can see just yet. In fact, Maya should be pushing back for Anarchy, so KT will have to send someone to deal with that. There's going to wave clear in mid. They're going to aggress onto Sunday. That's probably not a good idea.
No. And it's not that effective. Just get a Twisted Advance off. Nothing more.
That's percentage health damage, so, you know.
It's nice.
I don't know about the all-in harass of a Twisted Advance, but decided to use it anyway.
You know he had Flash, so he could have gotten out of there over the wall.
The standard Twisted Advance harassment into Flash away.
Yep.
Very good use of summoners.
Definitely I recommend that for laning trades.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Just go ahead, use your W onto somebody, Flash away. They won't expect it at all.
My only secret with Flash is if you're feeling really confident about the matchup, Flash before you get to lane, because if you get a kill, what a boss you are.
Very solid advice.
It's called hard mode.
Might as well just play with Clarity or something in that case. Well, anyway, back to top lane Tank Wars. Lyra wants to come up and join the fun, but Sunday says no, trots off back to his tower. Lyra trying to wrap around through the dry brush, not really going to work. Mickey just desperately wave clearing at the moment.
And unfortunately for Anarchy, even though they're even in kills, so much of this gold is on the Gragas. 3-0-1 compared to basically the gold exactly where you want to see it on KT. We're seeing a big dive though. Fate's Call is used. Ixu's low. A lot of low members. We're waiting to see if there's going to engage more members here. 4v3 though. One fall so far. So Anarchy finally getting some kills. They're going to keep pumping these arrows into Fixer.
Yeah, double kill. But look what's happening on the bottom side of the map. There is just no defense whatsoever. Now Hecarim going to be coming back into the top side. Hecarim has TP. Well, they just lost an inhib turret and a tier 2 for a tier 1. So KT shrugs their shoulders, walks away with the better trade.
Wasn't even a Lich Bane onto the Victor. It was just auto attacks and the Trinity Force procs from Corki with the BF sword. So it clearly had enough damage. Anarchy tunneling on kills, getting an outer turret. But as you mentioned, just no way that you could possibly equate that trade.
And they can't even chain it into another objective right here. Dragon's not up for 30 seconds. They don't really have the wave control. They got absolutely styled on in terms of map presence.
So we get the hard zoom on to score.
Hi, Fixer.
Hello. All right.
Okay, I guess we're doing this
now. Have you ever played a game in full zoom? It is really scary. Minions are huge, apparently. So now that our observer's gotten through whatever they were up to,
I have a feeling there were some jokes there being made by the Korean casters that actually pertained to what was going on.
Out of context.
Out of context. An OGN English cast story. Pretty much every time.
Don't think I read that one. Not that interesting, sorry.
Would you listen to it, though? Would you live it, Papa Smithy? Would you live that story?
I think I've already made my answer on that particular question. As we're looking for Anarchy to just try and make this team comp work. The gold deficit's not massive. There is still that potential big Ren set players now that the Bloodthirst has been completed. You don't see a lot of the Hurricane in general in Champions because, as you mentioned, it's a very high-risk build. I feel like they have to opt into a fight before the armor stacking just makes the auto-attack build kind of useless.
It may already be useless, actually, considering how close that Frozen Heart is to completion on Sunday.
He's going to have the gold when he backs.
Just terrorizing that top lane at the moment, and he's going to back right now that he has the minion wave right where he wants it. He's going to rock out before he does it. Get a pose. KT already on this objective, and there's really nothing that Anarchy can do unless they want to deal with a Frozen Heart and the Home Guard Pony right in their back line.
Just majestically galloping to the wolves, killing one of his animal brethren.
But he's half man, half animal. And aren't people animals anyway, Papa Smithy? Aren't we all just animals? The answer is yes.
It's true. I believe by definition, and certainly in the actions sometimes, the answer is yes.
Oh boy. Well, Anarchy really in a lot of trouble this game, especially now. Lock it done. So much magic resist, and Sunday just capable of
the
dealing with Songyun quite easily.
Mm-hmm. Mickey coming to ruin the party. Sunday probably just wanting to play Guitar Hero with that very large axe that he has there.
I don't know how fun it is to play Guitar Hero with a tree, though.
I mean, probably shouldn't knock it till you try it.
We'll have to set this up for you. Oh boy, big engage, huge headbutt pulled combo, and now Score gets pulled into the fight afterwards. Someday still in that front line, finds Lyra on the outside. Song Yun auto-hitting in the back line, but there is a massive, massive Hecarim ult. Good hold from Someday on that till the end of the fight. And that is a dead AD carry before Anarchy can really respond. Nagne now pushing forward with the rest of his team to get this tier 2 turret.
Why don't they just go take the inhibitor? There's two members down. They have an exposed inhibitor. They're finally going to remember that fact. It's probably a bit weird to have an inhibitor exposed so early in the game. But with the mana bars, I guess with the short death time, it's probably not a viable option.
No. That's the funny thing is getting that tier 2. You can't even get the open inhib off of it. As you transition right there, you have to go for the immediate objective, like you said, due to the short death timers, and now there's not really much follow-up that can be done. But a very nice fight from KT. Huge initial engage by Fixer, and then Someday just messed up Song Yun in the back
line. This is a very even fight. I mean, the engage from Fixer, as you mentioned, triple headbutt pulve. Snowfire acting around the bottom side of the map, just keeping Score engaged. Kalista free hits for a long time, but the person taking the brunt of the damage this fight is the Hecarim, who basically is immortal, has the Frozen Heart completed. It's when this next death ray comes in, they take down the Kalista. There's just really nothing Anarchy can do.
You saw the Chaos Storm placement, too, on top of those four members at the back line while the Hecarim ult was going down, and that was just such a devastating combo in favor of KT.
Perfect Hex Score actually is the next pickup. So they're picking up very early after the Lich Bane, very Faker-esque in that pickup, but it's been seeing building up a lot of steam so far in the scene. Makes you super, super fast. Someday probably should be scared of AD carries, but with all these items, certainly not the case.
No, he doesn't have anything to worry about right now. He's able just to charge forward, take that turret. One wonders why they're methodically going after these tier twos when there's an open inhibitor around. They could have just walked into that inhibitor instead. That was an option. They don't even need a minion wave. They can proxy it.
Maybe the fantasy points, Monty. That's always the consideration.
Oh, boy. That must be it. Well, KT, they have such great siege here, and they have two Sheens. That inhibitor would last like 3 seconds.
And you have to think, at least at some point in this game, it will be the third Trinity Force, completed by Someday. So two Trinity Force and the Sheen Lich Bane in the mid lane. So you're expecting to see plenty of turret damage, but it's not really a relevant factor when there's literally an exposed inhibitor that they're just not setting up any sort of minion pressure
to
make it
possible. Why are they sieging the mid lane right now?
Is it possible they don't know they took the turret down?
There's a bug on their minimap.
They're all playing locked camera. That's what's happening.
Okay, well, Someday instead. There we go.
Here we go. Yep.
We're on the right path now.
You don't even need a minion wave. Like, just take it.
They figured it out.
All right.
Hooray.
It's taking time, but there's literally nothing Anakin can do. They cannot look to fight in an open area like that. So the minions will eventually equalize and push out this bottom wave so then they can actually turn that into pressure in the other lanes. Snowflower getting cute, but man, it feels bad to buy a Catalyst on Canada.
Well, you know.
The Righteous Glory,
yeah, the glory.
That'll feel great, but when you're just sitting on the Catalyst, it's kind of like when you buy a Sheen on a non-mana champion. You buy the Mana Crystal, and you're like, I should have waited till I had all the gold.
Oh, that is a bummer, getting pieces of a Sheen.
I think you just buy a pink ward, and you just deal with it.
I agree with you, actually.
Arrow's literally done nothing this game. He's poking around.
Yep.
He's gone literally for the ultimate poke build in Bloodthirsty Trinity Force.
He has to make sure that he's not going to get one shot by the Ahri. That's the goal.
Maybe he's a secret agent, 003. He's going along. One of James Bond's backup agents.
Well, an inferior agent, though.
Yes. The higher the number, the better.
Yeah.
006 didn't turn out very well.
Well, he did for a while. But, I mean, that's just the Sean Bean curse for you right there.
Yep. Not really a way for him to live, it seems.
At least he's still alive in real life. He's got that going for him.
From Sheffield. He's a good. He seems like a cool guy.
I have a theory for you, Papa
Smithy. I'm listening.
So maybe that's actually his way of becoming immortal. It's like the picture of Dorian Gray, where the picture of Dorian Gray gets older. It's Sean Bean's characters die, but each character that dies prevents a real-life death for Sean Bean.
as a possibility. I think he just has issues because, well, speaking of issues, Sunday has none of those. He's super, super tanky. But isn't it weird that as a professional actor, you know, when he's showing movies to his children, like he has probably three to show.
Well, that's so disturbing.
Like, you can't show any of these movies. It's like, yeah, just turn it off at 20 minutes. It's fine.
No one wants to see Daddy die. That's so funny.
He just must have a very limited catalog to show from.
Oh, hilarious.
Sunday, he's actually taking a lot of damage, so he's tanky, but not that tanky. He has to back away eventually. They get 50% of the turret damage, and Mickey's going to make an engage, but Anarchy, they have no good options.
Well, there's a charm onto Fixer. May force him to blow his ultimate. No, Fixer not with his finger on the trigger right there. Just pulling back at the last second. They did maybe get some advantages over this Baron right now. Still a lot of Anarchy wards, though. Sunday wants to clean up this game with a magnificent cavalry charge into the back line.
I actually would have liked, speaking of back line charge, we're going to see the home guard engage come through. It's probably been spotted out. Here
we go, straight onto Sung Yun.
Doesn't have Trinity Force, remember?
Yeah, it does flash out. So Sung Yun not taking as much damage with the help of that Bloodthirster shield. Nagne still trying to follow up, and that is a lot of damage onto Maokai. Trying to clear out these wards. Now they have to go for this Baron. They have stalled out enough time that the super minions are on the Nexus turret, so that means free Baron. Baron's for free.
Lira,
double smite.
Oktoberfest. He's going to get caught out trying to go for it. Flash into the disengage. Very nice there, but should mean the free Baron, like you suggested. They're poking around the area. Multiple members now around, but yeah, they peel off. Actually, Snowfire's caught. Do they have the range on the Alistar? Fate's call takes him away, but Sunday ults in.
And now he's going to find both of them right there. He gets charmed up on the side. Teleport going to be coming in from Ixiu, but Nagne right in the middle of things. Will he actually survive? No, he gets killed by Mickey, actually. Now Fixer in the mix, knocking everyone up. Ixiu takes a headbutt, but Lyra does enough damage here that they actually will have to pull back KT Sunday, not with enough HP to continue.
It's actually a really poor play from Nagne. It's important to notice that Sunday has itemized full tank. He doesn't even have a Sheen for any semblance of damage. And Arrow has gone for just a putrid build when you're talking about damage. He literally only does poke with Trinity Force Sorcerer Shoes Bloodthirster. Nagne flashed into his death, and there was no damage to win despite the fact that they're up 7,000 gold.
Well, I think AT getting a little troll right now, trying to force this game a bit too hard. Could have absolutely just gone onto the Baron right there with very low risk, but Sunday was refusing to tank it, trying to get that pick on the outside, maybe not really understanding that he doesn't have any damage.
That's the thing, he rode in, and even though he had 5 points in his devastating charge and an auto attack, it did maybe 300 damage.
Yeah, well, they got a dragon at the very least, and now there's a Thornmail for Sunday. It's like he is really wanting to go for that full tank in this game.
But then Nagne needs to be on point with his position. Used Flash Cleanse just to pick up
also,
the kill onto
Sun. Also, he didn't even have Zhonya's either. Like, there's some justification from that if you have a Zhonya's Hourglass to play that aggressively, but without that, it was just quite silly.
Well, he just must have thought with his team being so far ahead there'd be damage from other sources, but Arrow does not do damage.
Oh, too funny. Well, Lyra going to get found out by a Chilling Smite. Sunday gets stunned up a little bit there by Snowflower. Still a lot of death ray damage coming in. Sunday eating quite a bit before that happens, though. The inhibitor's back up now, so the pressure from that angle is gone.
This is very peculiar play from KT.
Well, I mean, welcome to the last week and a half.
Yep. They still haven't got this outer turret here, Anarchy, so they just don't have much space to move around. The charm comes through, but it's doesn't really have a lot of damage behind it. That's the pick onto Mickey. Uses the Spirit Rush. Sunday, again, doesn't have a lot of damage. So he wants to change targets. It's Victor that is the true damage threat of this team. But without Flash, he has to play pretty conservatively. We're waiting to see if we do see the Onslaught of Shadow. Still hasn't been used. Pushes Ixiu back. Snowfire comes in. We're watching Nagne in the backline doing damage, but Sunday has decent base first. The Maokai dies, and Sunday's still going.
And that was just a good follow-up from Nagne using that speed, but the Kalista actually kills the Hecarim right there. KT has such a gold advantage and such a firm control over this game, but they just can't execute. Score was trying to flash underneath Mickey to make a play, which was just very easily Spirit Rushed out of, so a really strange engage.
It's this weird scenario where because Someday doesn't do damage, you remember when Hecarim was first starting to come back into the meta, people talked about the fact that, okay, he doesn't have a lot of CC, so how does he actually function as a backline tank? The big thing for him is that he needs the damage threat to actually affect your positioning, because when it's Someday full tank, you take that initial burst of, what, 500 damage, and you just kind of ignore him, and okay, he's chipping away at your health totals, but once you have a Bloodthirster, you're spreading the bolts onto multiple members, you have effectively probably 30-35% lifesteal just from the Bloodthirster because of the Hurricane interaction. They're just ignoring Someday, and until he finishes damage, KT are having these awkward fights where Someday's in the backline 2-3 screens away from the Victor, who kind of wants people to come to him, and the Rockets are doing nothing.
Right, and I mean, all he has to build is a Sheen, and he's instantly going to nearly double his damage output, so it's a pretty pretty important pickup here for Someday, unless we actually see some form of damage finish from Arrow, who's still just been sitting on this pickaxe for quite some time.
Yeah, I don't know what to think about some of the decisions by KT after they played so well for 20 minutes. The last 16 has been curious. They don't have a lot of CC. I mean, the Alistar hasn't been getting to the backline to set up a Victor Wombo. We already mentioned during Champions that the Anarchy are excellent at kiting backwards, and that's actually been a prophecy that's come true. They keep kiting backwards. Kalista's been basically free-hitting or just taking no damage in general, and you just end up at these stalemates despite the fact that there's multiple things KT could be doing. Set up a push around the bot side and take this inhibitor. You already took a free inhibitor as Anarchy watched on. Okay, the gold value hasn't changed, so it's still only a 6,000 gold lead, but they're milling around, and there is always a risk.
Also right there, Someday wasn't split pushing. Well, Ixu still doesn't have TP up. They had a good long period of time where they could have just split pushed with this TP and forced a Baron.
And now it's back up.
Yep. Indeed.
And honestly, even though he does no damage, he also takes no damage, so he's happy to be in the split push.
All right, KT wants to make a play. They have everyone from Anarchy there. Someday getting charmed, Someday getting so low as to ult back out. Now, will they be able to take a kill? Lyra, very tanky. Mickey gonna finish off Arrow on the outside, and now Fixer gets charmed into the middle of the fight, and that is it. Looks like there's the Slicing Maelstrom. KT may get aced right here. Nagne gonna go down. That's gonna be a Baron for Anarchy. Oh boy.
No guarantee of it yet. Still teleport and level 17 smite available for Someday. But what is 100% guaranteed was a very comfortable team fight win. This lack of damage is really palpable.
Well, against the late game Maokai too, what are you gonna do? Even if the Corki gets an auto attack range, he didn't even have a last whisper.
And the Victor only finally got damage onto Sungyun when he basically went in for the trade kill himself. So it was only Kalista opening up her positioning that allowed Victor, a fairly short to medium range mage, to actually do damage to a priority target.
Well, the death of Sungyun definitely saved that Baron from going down, because there was plenty of opportunity and plenty of ability to secure it. KT really falling apart in the late game.
Not building any damage.
No, he's not.
Oh, dear.
What would he be building right now?
He really needs a Guardian Angel.
I mean, either Banshee's Veil or Guardian Angel is not a good pickup. Now, Papa, it could be Hexdrinker.
Okay, that's more than nothing. I mean, honestly, the Maw would be pretty good, because of course you get that extra 35-40 AD as you fall lower in health, and he's been doing that because he's basically... The engage so far has been Someday running at four people and hoping to not die as his team like gallops up towards the fight. So, look, maybe the fifth dragon will be the ultimate Eaglizer. 12% bonus stats, maybe that's enough. And
The true damage is really what comes through with that fifth dragon. I mean, that's what they need right now. That true damage would change so much about this game.
So KT have a lot of options. If they do see Anarchy start the Baron, they can just have Hecarim teleport bot and take the inhibitor. They could try and engineer some sort of trade. They take the dragon for free, so 45 and a half minutes is when the fifth dragon might be a big consideration factor. And as you mentioned, just with natural attack speed growth, the true damage will be relevant given how unkillable the Hecarim will be in the late game. So maybe that's what they have to look for, but with a comp like they have,
Righteous Glory coming in. Fixer wants the engage. Fixer pops his ultimate Death Ray on the outside. Good zoning gravity field. Someday can't find an angle to come in, and that'll mean Fixer goes down very early. Arrows knocked up, knocked around by the explosive cast. Someday has done nothing this team fight, and that'll be a flash for score. They're trying to finish him off, and they will. Oh, boy.
This would be.
Someday didn't even get remotely close to the back lines of that engagement. He was just running in circles on the outside.
And KT have somehow engineered their own downfall, a 16-minute inhibitor going down. And they've, what, taken it down once, not really prepped minions around the area. Someday could be the hero and steal Baron. Remember, he has a level 18 smite. But it's probably going to be too late.
Well, can he TP? Will he TP? 2,000 HP, he's not going to choose to do it. Baron to Anarchy here. Well, this is interesting.
I'm almost out of words. We're going to see a replay of the fight. Fixer really wants to make the engage. Remember, he hasn't been able to get the priority targets in Headbutt Pole for a long time, but dies for free in that area. Someday, he's like, all right, I'm going to get this angle. Maybe I'll get it now as Sung-Yu moves forward. But watch this. When he notices
the
Arrow
angle.
Dying, he just backs away because Arrow's dead. There isn't the damage. He doesn't have a Trinity Force. He doesn't actually do anything if his carries die. And that's the awkward fact.
I mean, that was effectively a 5v4 because Someday was just patrolling the periphery. Sure, he was zoned out a little bit by the Ahri, but you have to be able to commit with that ultimate right there. Otherwise, you just don't have any threat, and they run over Score and Fixer. Once Fixer's ult is done, once his knockup, his combo is completed, there's nothing else to do. He just stands there and dies.
That's unfortunately been the reality. It's a very low damage build from Corki, as well as prioritize safety and poke over any consistent damage, and Corki literally does not damage Gragas or Maokai. You're pointing to the screen, I can see that you're talking about that the Sheen is finally complete. Okay, it's only a Sheen, but it's the start of something that is super necessary for KT.
Yeah, the question is now, is it too late here to deal with? I mean, they still have a very high...
Very smart build coming through with Sung-Yu. So 30% lifesteal just from those two items. As the bolt hits, that's effectively going to be half lifesteal on each of those autos. We're talking about 50% lifesteal. Effectively, if he's hitting multiple targets, it's going to be hard for the Sheen to threaten. So yeah, the Trinity Force burst, maybe, but the Sheen, it's getting outscaled.
Yeah, definitely is. And Someday still taking a lot of poke damage right now from this Ahri. As they try and take down some of these tier twos, they've nearly equalized in terms of gold, and that'll do it. Not like it matters this much. 42 minutes into the game, Nagde on a desperate defense right now. And KT really has to pull it together. Iksu going to take some decent poke damage from the Lich Bane.
Nagde does a lot of damage, but honestly, maybe he should actually itemize into the Fuhrer boost that we saw Raphael when he played Victor in the LPL, because it seems like even with the Hex Core upgrade, he's not getting in a position to do damage. It's a very strong tank frontline. And then this Kennen doing a lot of work, can't walk through the ultimate from Kennen, the Slicing Maelstrom. So with all these zones, Anarchy slowly moving forward, playing very assertive League of Legends, picking up the objectives with the Baron, and the split push continues from Mickey.
Yeah, don't think they're going to actually be able to crack the base here. The Baron buff will be running out pretty darn soon.
If I've learned one thing from this game, that cracking the base seems to mean nothing, because KT did it 30 minutes ago.
Well, to be fair to KT, as soon as they, after the first time they did it, because there's this Kalista on the other team, they couldn't actually give, they couldn't commit to that inhibitor without first pushing up all the lanes to make sure that there wasn't going to be a counter Baron play from Anarchy. So they actually did play around it like relatively well. It was the team fights that were the big problem.
Yeah, that's a fair point. I feel like Kalista, who was very underfarmed at that point, okay, but it's a one Baron threat. Ahri doesn't have a lot of Baron damage. Nobody else on the lineup really does damage to Baron. Gragas is okay, especially for a tank jungler. It's not quite the Cassiopeia Kalista where I'd 100% commit to your idea, but they haven't been able to engineer team fights. They haven't been able to engineer Wade pushes. They haven't picked up the big objectives. Okay, in a minute 15, if they win a big 5-for-1, 5-for-2 fight around the fifth dragon, maybe then they can finish. But for how far ahead they were in almost every regard and breaking the base literally at 15 minutes, KT have done a lot of milling around for 30 minutes later.
Yes, they have. Undoubtedly. Someday now with the Trinity Force.
Okay.
So finally scraping together enough gold. And this may be the deal breaker as this next dragon arrives. Mickey zooming out with home guards and
almost doesn't catch his orb. He's moving so fast away.
Has the sorcery elixir as well. Now this is going to be the big one. Can KT actually get this dragon? They desperately need it at this point.
It is amazing that Anarchy is ahead in gold.
Yes, absolutely incredible. Well, Someday not wanting to make the teleport flank play here at the very least.
They must be worried about the backline.
Leroy actually gets caught. That is huge. Victor going for Chaos Storm. Nagde trying to be the hero. Can't kill the jungler, but gets him low enough. Now everyone focusing Ixu. Someday on the other side provides a target for the Twisted Advance. But that's a Valk over the wall. That's an ultimate. That's a dead tree. Eventually.
And now there are many, many things that KT can pick up. Fifth Dragon. Baron will be spawning in a couple minutes, but the fifth dragon especially, suddenly the backline threat of a true damage 12% bonus that Trinity Force Hecarim will do the job they were looking for. No way for Aniki to contest. They're even going to move forward to stop Gragas, even having a hope. And everyone's burning, NBA Jam style. And maybe this is finally the go button for KT.
I would certainly hope so, especially because they don't have to worry about a counter Baron being taken right now. They should be able to methodically close this. And that is such, the Corki Rockets with the five Dragon Stacks is just one of the worst things to play against.
There it is, there's the true damage burning down. No one's having any fun on the side of Anarchy. It's, again, a free. Every time they finally got to this inhibitor, there's been no defense whatsoever from Anarchy. So they've seeded what they needed to do. And in this case, obviously, there was absolutely no way they could fight for it. But can KT, they haven't got a minion wave. The big thing is the minion wave from Anarchy in top lane actually needs to be addressed.
Yeah.
Or they could die.
Or they could die. I think they should just dive right now. Use this five Baron. They're going to agree with me. There's the Righteous Glory popped. Everyone having to back off. Ixu still dead. In this late game, Mixi wants to make a play, and Anagne is not going to get the angle. Has to use two charges back out on the Spirit Rush.
Two inhibitors down. Obviously, statistically, it's looking very, very difficult for Anik to come back in this game, but we thought the same thing 30 minutes ago. They take down another outer turret. They're not going to be able to break the base. Perhaps the key thing is that Anarchy with their Avenge could never break the base, but KT did that much earlier, so it was much easier to move forward. Not really any items to pick up, although Arrow, still no kill this game, still 0-2-6. He's 3-item AD carry at 47 minutes. I don't think I have ever seen less damage on a 75,000 gold
pretty,
team.
It's pretty terrible, honestly. The fact that he went for the QSS right here, too, I mean, does it really even matter if he stays alive at this point, considering how little damage he does?
Nope.
I just take the risk of going for something. Now, Anarchy going to try and actually sneak this out. Looks like this is their last hope. They're going to try and get it down. It's about 10K right now, under 10K, but this is probably the end of Anarchy.
They're just going to try and go for the Kalista 50-50, but they have to re-engage. A Slicing Maelstrom rips through the team. Sungyu finally turns his aggro. He's still free hitting. That's the important fact here. They're actually onto Arrow. Arrow's going to die solo in the back line. Hecarim's very, very strong, but waiting for Kalista to get back in this fight. Nagnade's super, super low. Can the Kalista do enough damage onto Someday? He's just moving around. We're waiting for the Ren to actually use it. He Rends.
There's the Ren. And oh my, Fixer is the only one alive right now, but Anarchy can't actually close this game in the end. It doesn't look like they may try and charge the base. Long death timers, can they actually close?
They only have Cannon for wave clear, so it's, look, he's got stuns, maybe he can buy a little bit of time, but they need to at minimum break the base. I don't even know if that's a pass mark. They have a lot of damage on the Sungyu.
I think they can actually finish this game right now. 35 seconds. This Alistar has to be an absolute hero at the moment. He may wait for his unbreakable will. Kennen's doing all he can to defend. They've got, Fixer has to keep him off the turret, but he has no ult quite yet.
20 seconds left for Corki. He can fix it by any semblance of time. That is going to dive onto him. He's going to die instantly.
That's it.
Anarchy are going to win a game that looked over at 16 minutes.
What a comeback from Anarchy. But wow, KT with a massive slip up, and we're going to go to game three.
This is not a team you can take lightly. SKT found that out. Now KT played an excellent 15 minutes, brought this game completely into her advantage, and then just threw it away.
Absolutely. Over-aggression was the name of the game for KT, but Anarchy keeps their cool and they keep fighting back and it pays off.
Crazy that they can make this game. We're going to see a replay soon, I imagine, of this final fight. The fact that they could win against a five Dragon buff, I don't even believe that the buff had expired, at least on my monitor. It's showing that they're still glowing red. No one could actually get onto the Kalista.
I mean, Arrow falked into the Slicing Maelstrom in that last fight and got stunned. He opted into that. Mickey did corral him in that direction. But even so, Arrow really late to use his QSS as well. A very poor fight. We're taking a look at it right now from KT.
Yeah, we're just seeing it on our monitors. Sungyoon, no real threat, and then Sunflower gets launched onto Corki. They just kill him alone, basically, in the back line. Surreal to see both these teams, but Anarchy, they stick to their guns. They've been consistent. If KT falter again, they could realistically win this series.
Absolutely. Varus ban going to be first for KT. Varus LeBlanc and Thresh, their bans on the blue side from last game. Rise taken out for Anarchy. Will we just see the same bans over again? Cassiopeia and Annie were banned by Anarchy.
The Annie play from Fixer was impressive, just getting some of those engage options. The less engaged they have, the better, apparently, because when it was just Hecarim, they had no idea of how to play around what seemed to be pretty straightforward team fights. Kalista actually banned this time by Anarchy, not trusting that KT won't snap it up with first pick.
Yeah, indeed. So a little bit of a change here. That means Cassiopeia or Annie will be available for KT Rolster. Will the Snowflower be free for Thresh be free for Snowflower as well? Getting into that point of the night where you're casting six games in a row and you start to get a little bit tongue-tied.
Word salad sounding a bit tasty, Monte Cristo. We haven't had much dinner either, so just hoping we can see a triumphant performance by one of these teams. Ari's the last ban. That's a curious one to me. Mickey played it fine. He won the MVP, but that game was not won off the back of Ari.
Well, also, I think it really, after you ban both Varus and Ari, telegraphs that you want to pick the victor here.
Yep.
And Anarchy can also pick the victor. So are you going to first pick the victor?
That sounds like a gambit. So when you have last pick, especially, you can engineer a comp for a lot of different champions. It seems like your instincts are correct. Just going with first pick victor, I feel there's a lot of counterplay to this pick in a lot of ways, but we're just cycling through some of the strong champions. Gragas is also another one that's been heavily contested. Where do KT want to go with this comp? That's the question that we just honestly don't know the answer to.
Well, they obviously feel Mickey's the threat. Three mid lane bans right there, and I think you just take the Alistar here. But again, why ban the Ahri? Because now if you ban the Ahri, Mickey may just take Victor. They could take Gragas Victor right now.
And it's not like he hasn't shown the Victor already. He clearly can play that champion. The Gragas will be absolutely no surprise, been by far Lyra's strongest champion. Has the pick of the jungle, though. No jungler's ban. In fact, so far we've had four mid lane bans, an AD carry, and a top laner.
I think you just go Gragas Victor here and say, if you're Anarchy, you get a powerful mid laner. A lot of the counter picks to Victor have already been banned out. So in a way, KT doing some of that work for you.
Considering something different, though, it has to be Sivir duty this time for Arrow. You cannot let him get back onto the Corki. That was not a good performance from him, and Vayne is not really a blocker pick, but certainly an opponent that can take over lane. I agree with you. Maybe the Thresh, maybe the Victor, whichever one, I think, just taken the first round, but clearly they're heavily considering other options.
No. I think you take the Victor, Gragas, here, 100%, and that looks like it will be their lock-in.
Just waiting for the time down. Yes, it is. Weird to put yourself in this position where you're not willing to pull the trigger on first picking Victor, and then your options to deal against it. Do you just go Kassadin?
That was a very weird ban phase from KT. I think that this was very predictable that Anarchy would opt into this if you did make these assumptions.
It has Nogne to be Kassadin.
Okay, well, there's possible that it's going to be an extra level of mind game here. Maybe these bans were to force Anarchy to pick the Victor early so they could counterpick with the Kassadin. That's actually possible.
I was going to say Kassadin Sivir will be the duo, because of course Sivir makes up for Kassadin's lack of wave clear, and Arrow cannot be put back onto the Corki or any other champion. Just stick with the Sivir, does the team thing, I think. Yeah, I don't mean to rag too much, but that was a poor game.
It was. And this could be very much going the way of
instant lock Vayne from Sungyoon. You can take over this lane. If they misplay it here, KT, and you get that Blade of the Ruin King fast enough, whether it's a lane swap or just 2v2, Thresh Vayne, very confident lock-ins from Anarchy.
Indeed. And this is going the way of the Ku Tigers comp for KT that we saw in that final and decisive third game where they picked the Riven, going for the Sivir and Kassadin combination here, except they went for the Annie. Instead, it's the Alistar, still serving a lot of the same function. This Vayne's going to have to be very careful in the back line, though. I would not want to be playing the Vayne this game. But the Vayne-Gragas combo, very strong in general. Good pickup, pick setup. Not so great with the Victor, though.
If you think about it like the last game, where basically They kited back for the Kalista, and Kalista ended up doing free damage. Use that gravity field defensively. Use all this CC defensively. Maybe there's a way for Vayne to do damage. I don't really see it. Score is considering this Rengar.
I can't deal with another game of Score as Rengar, Papa Swimmy.
You very well may have to. I don't know if that was your heart sinking or just necessarily your arm, but the Rengar's locked in.
Yes, it is. Well, the last time this happened, we did see that there was a pretty big issue with the Rengar pickup right now. It was, in fact, not effective at all in the late game.
So Anarchy left to pick their top laner, as far as we can tell. We're waiting to see what they picked. It's against a Rumble. There could be the potential of a carry choice. Of course, Smeb showed us the power of the Riven top. In that particular matchup, not sure if Ixu is that's a champion that Ixu plays. Could just default back to the Hecarim. Doesn't have the Sivir synergy, but would definitely be a very valid pick. It'd be a bit of backline threat, but I don't really know if they need backline threat when they want to keep their Vayne alive more than necessarily die of a Sivir that isn't really going to be zoned away from our other threats.
They don't need any backline dive right now. KT only has one direction with this comp, which is all in for absolutely everybody. In this team composition, there's no other way to deal with it. And now that they have it, the Hecarim, I think, is just not going to be that useful here.
Look, there's always the potential that Hecarim takes over a game, maybe similar to what Sumda did last game, but build a bit of damage early and just be a true damage threat or a big split pushing threat. For example, Duke yesterday doing very impressive things on the Hecarim and the split push. It's going to be the teleport ignites. They're not going to be going for the Cinder Hulk build. Could maybe just rush the Trinity Force, have the Ignite, and just try and dual Rumble out of the lane.
Yeah, he will absolutely be doing that. Now, the big threat here is Mickey. This is a composition that is designed around diving this Victor and Score. Played Rengar before, didn't really do a whole lot, built Warrior Enchantment, and was absolutely useless in the late game. If Nagde hadn't carried them out of that game on IM, it would have been an absolute disaster for KT. So I'm not convinced by the Rengar in the current era. Yes, he's strong in the mid game, but he has such a low, he doesn't do anything at all in the late game. He might as well not even be on your team.
That's harsh words, Monte Cristo, but not too far off base, I think. Definitely has good lockdown CC if he can get the empowered bowler. In the laning phase, maybe his whole job is just hang around mid lane, get this casting going, and let Nagne do all the hard work in the late game.
Well, you have to create a massive snowball. Otherwise, you're just useless compared to a Gragas later on, because a tanky Rengar is not something anyone is afraid of. Oh, boy. Well, I hope it works better than last time. I miss Rengar.
One more game, Monty.
Well, one more game left tonight. Let's see if this Rengar delivers this time for KT, or whether Anarchy can take the 2-1.
Fans here at this game, Monte Cristo, getting to the wee hours of the night, but the fans, they want to see a winner, and it looked for sure like it'll be a 2-0 for KT, but Anarchy fight back, and it's 1-1.
You know, I'm not sure we're going to see a winner tonight, Papa Smithy. Sometimes you just have to declare both teams as losers. That's our job.
Only one team can pick up the big W, though. It's a retail brand in Australia, so a couple of layers to that joke.
The big W?
It's like Target, but not as good.
Oh. Well,
it's like Kmart, but not as good.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Oh, that's bad. That's bad.
It's probably on the same level. I'm being too harsh, Big W.
Do you apologize to Big W? Well, there goes our Big W sponsorship for OGN, Papa Smithy. Thanks
Sorry,
a lot.
Guys. I messed it up.
Okay. Well, looks like we are going to have a lane swap, but both teams heading into the top side right now. 2v2 for the Alistar Sivir versus the Vayne and the Thresh. Meanwhile, weak side jungle starts from both sides, but
one of them heeding your advice. You can see KT starting the big buff, so theoretically they might be in three buff territory, but because there's been this duo lane, or basically the 2v2 lane, move to the top, probably not going to be so much harassment and maybe be safer jungle clears for both teams.
Well, we'll see. It depends on how fast this Sivir can push things in. Score is going to take the red buff right at level 1. Someday just doing a camp right now, trying to hit level 2 before he TPs into the bottom side.
Absolutely no one there, so watching the minions do battle in the bottom side of the map. The jungle follow continues. It's just picking up experience where you can.
Yep, absolutely. So Ixu going back, getting his green ward, getting some potions as well. Doran's shield start from Sunday, so it looks like we will see a pretty conservative lane right here. All eyes are on Score. What will he do with this Rengar? Can he actually find the angles? Mickey, they have to play very, very patiently, very conservatively, very defensively this game against a Rengar.
Definitely needs some wards to relieve pressure, because at the moment he's pushing the cast in, usually a pretty smart choice, but with the power of Rengar's early game, could be his downfall.
And Snowflower coming in. No hook right there onto the blue buff. Lyra wants to look for the invade right now. Score is not level 3 because he hasn't actually taken out those small camps yet. Lyra's going to grab him for himself. That's a lot of XP, actually.
And they moved a lot of the experience onto the small minions, so the full clear of the camp, super important. Rengar's early clear, still really risky, and the payoff, look, maybe it'll be there this game, but there's a reason that this champion's just not seen very much at the competitive level.
It's just such a risk is the problem. It's such a risk to take the Rengar that says that you're going to have to make some big plays early on, or the rest of your team is basically going to have to hard carry you.
Well, so look, we saw the jungle Fizz come through from Tucson, and we kind of questioned that pick. They at least paid it off with an early gank, but then just fell into irrelevance. Very much the same possibility for the Rengar. People were really trying these off-meta picks, and this was without their hands being forced. There were a lot of viable junglers not picked or banned. In fact, I don't believe there was a jungle ban this game.
No, there were no jungle bans, as a matter of fact, at all, because of the emphasis on the mid lane. And we know that Score can play Sejuani really well, for
example.
No,
come on, let's be real. Where is the Evelynn? It was an obvious Evelynn game. It wasn't even a Rek'Sai locked in, so Rek'Sai, Evelynn, both were very viable options.
I just wonder what it is, because in KT's other game, they by all rights should have lost that game that they came back with the Rengar with their 3 inhibs down, and the Rengar was totally useless. Now we see it here again.
We can only guess the scrim results are very good with it. Maybe they just want to get a huge lead in the early game. What else could it be?
To be fair to Score, he actually did draw a lot of Rengar bans early last season. People were very afraid of him on that champion, and he did deliver. But since the meta's shifted out, and you can't make all of those big impactful plays anymore into the mid game, you just don't have a lot of time. There's a countdown ticking. And to Lyra's credit, slowing that Rengar down is absolutely huge.
Yeah, he's already
absolutely
gone,
huge.
As you mentioned, contested and stole away the quick level 3, then has now gone and put out 2 green wards and a pink. Doesn't have any semblance of a sightstone, just spending all of his income on denying the Rengar. And as you mentioned, when you're talking about a timer, delaying that timer is important. Nung Knight's not level 6.
Oh, barely not hitting that.
Mickey was out of map.
Yeah, he was. That's true. And also, the body slam narrowly missing right there. That may have actually been a change. That actually was one of those things that could have been affected by the nerfs to his body slam on the last patch. It was real close.
Yeah. Gragas lost a bit of weight in the last patch. He just doesn't quite have the same belly radius anymore.
He's been walking around Summoner's Rift so much these days that he probably...
It's true. He's gotten quite the workout in the last few patches.
Yeah, he definitely has. I mean, been drinking a lot, but piling on the calories in that way, I suppose, but still perhaps offsetting it with enough running around a valley that I guess is on top of a mountain, if I'm to believe, like, what's going on.
Are we going to have another lore discussion, Monte Cristo?
I just look out at the outside of Summoner's Rift, and it seems to be like some sort of crater on top of a mountain.
Have you noticed I've done some more animations? Actually, quite a lot going on out there.
Yeah, it is really pretty, but also,
I don't know how I find time. I should probably be killing creeps when I'm checking out the sick...
The scenic views.
The scenic views. Real estate in Summoner's Rift, probably quite expensive.
Is that what you do in solo queue too? You're just laying right there. You're like, hey, you just type in all chat. Did you see the dragonfly around outside? And then while they're looking over at the screen, you killed them?
I just all chat, type D for dance. It's always what I do. I've been thwarted by the people that run Ignite on D. Those people I don't want to talk about, but Everyone has their own strategy to win a solo queue.
Well,
nothing's happened in this game.
Nothing at all. Except Arrow coming out with a pretty nice CS lead in the top side.
Probably not unexpected, of course. Sivir versus Vayne has so many more options. Can push, can control the wave, can hold it.
Alira's coming over here right now to contest, actually, this red buff. Looks like Nagne wants to collapse a little bit. Vicky actually trying to zone him out. Nagne going to get stunned right here. And very, very close. Nagne has to back off as Lyra starts to walk up towards the river, but Nagne actually fooled Mickey. We didn't see the first part of that trade, but when the death ray came in, he just rift walked right on top of him instead of going to help his jungler right there. So Mickey overcommitting and being the victim of a little bit of a mind game.
Did you notice how much minion damage he was taking? It was a good 200 damage just from minions to really equalize that trade towards Nagne. It's a smart play, as you mentioned, bluffing aggression just to stop any hope of collapsing with the jungle and buys Rengar a little bit of time. Rengar's down bottom lane.
Here we go. And there's the root on the ultimate. That'll be first blood, and it's given over to Someday. Well, the first ult worked this time around.
And look, we see Twisted Fate games where we kind of levy the same problems with him as a champion. So look, if you get all those throw the hunts off, maybe the snowball can happen this game, but they almost achieved but could not quite finish out last game.
But Papa Smithy, the difference with Twisted Fate is that he has a global ultimate, and also that he has a Zhonya's Hourglass to avoid that. Oh, and also his root, his stun, is not a skill shot. It is targeted. So there's a lot different, I feel, with the Twisted Fate.
I take a lot of issue with you trying to explain to me that Twisted Fate and Rengar have different kits, good sir.
I'm just saying it's a big difference in story as Sangyun gets just
flash
ambushed.
Sangyun can do nothing whatsoever. Doesn't even have level 6, although flashes and heals. Fleet of Foot, though, doing a lot of work. Just the heal coming through from Fixer. Tanks up the turret. He almost made a really crafty escape, but it's second kill of the game to KT.
Yeah, they certainly look to have tightened things up here. We'll see if they can actually pull it out. Clearly, they had a very strong early game in the last one that they failed to close on, so no promises yet. Nagne gets flayed, and the death sentence, there's the ultimate. Flash, does he have enough for the Riftwalk? Yes, he does, over the wall, just barely.
Didn't have the catalyst, but of course just had the Ruby Crystal, which was literally all that was stopping him from his death. So good play there. Sivir takes the turret. The Vayne lane certainly not going as planned for Sungyu.
Yeah, that's... I mean, they tried to lane swap. It was called by Arrow.
Honestly, Snowflower left lane. Like they understood that this was only going to go one way. So they tried to make a play around mid. At least they got a bit of pressure for the victor. But in terms of laning, it's going to be a while till Vayne has the Blade of the Rune King and really threaten the all-in onto Sivir.
And there we go. At least Anarchy will steal away a blue buff right there. A minor win for them. Mickey already has his blue. So that'll be KT a little bit delayed right there. Nagne not going to have that same ability to wave clear, really. Now, who's going to go for this dragon first right now? They do see Vayne in the top side. This should, in theory, be a pretty free dragon for KT Rollster.
Throw the hunt available again. Warrior Enchant completed, so is ahead in terms of jungle items.
Oh boy, is this the ultra-fast gank squad coming through right
here?
On
the thrill of the hunt is activated.
Oh boy, Lyra sees it. And he's going to get pulverized out. However, the Condemn will knock Fixer out of the way, so no kill reaped out of that situation.
I also misspoke. Arrow only now getting Throw the Hunt available. So on the Throw the Hunt did not happen.
What a great combo.
That sounds pretty nifty.
For diving with an invincible Alistar thanks to his ultimate. I mean, in that way, the turret dive is actually amazing from this composition. No taking that away from them.
Yeah, I mean, if Alistar can just tank forever, Warrior Enchant, Rengar still does a lot of damage. There's a reason that one of the standbys of Korean solo queue is the top Rengar. Probably a little bit less damage from the jungle, but...
I see you've discovered that already.
Yeah, there's a lot of it.
Yes,
if it's not Riven, it's Rengar.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry for you in advance. You haven't actually seen that many teleport Smite Master Yi's,
no,
though.
No, I haven't seen one. I've seen plenty of Yi. I got carried by Yi, so... I mean, Faker's made it happen, so I'm sure the Yi bans and the Yi mid is happening in droves.
Well, yeah, it's just always been, for years, that common jungle pick in the Korean server. Snowflower still really wants to get Mickey rolling.
Well, Vayne's freezing and getting solo experience, so at least picking up quite a lot of experience in the top lane. So I like the way they've maneuvered their lanes. Doesn't need to be uncountable.
KT has to punish this freeze, though. You can't just let this go unanswered right now.
They must not interested in the dragon.
I mean, if they let Anarchy have a freeze and a dragon, I don't know what to say. This is a very poor map play. They know it's going down. Everyone is already there. Here we go, TP. All right, so they actually are going to react to this in the end. Now, what could they get for an equalizer across the choke? Lyra on the lantern, but the damage just a little bit too much from Someday. And now the dragon finished off by Someday himself. Very awkward positioning on the map, though. You had plenty of time. KT should have collapsed on that dragon immediately.
It's a small amount of punishment given the situation. It's why we don't see a lot of freezing of lanes, especially after the turret is down. Because there's so much counterplay. It's Sivir versus Vayne. Okay, not in a 1v1 sense, but Sivir has the movement speed, is able to train down turrets, make plays across the map, make the Vayne accountable. Because if she just shows up with a Blade of the Ruined King in Sivir's lane, there's plenty of possibilities. Speaking of making people accountable, Ixu's caught, gets away, and this time there's no bowler. Although, with the Thrill of the Hunt, on the Thrill of the Hunt, combo comes out, misses the bowler strike, though. Need to hit those skill shots if you're going to pick the Rengar.
Yeah, you have to be so perfect on this Rengar to really justify its pickup. And the chase right there not ending fruitfully, but they do get the tower. So the objective is at least controlled, but they used a lot of summoners not to get a kill there. And remember, Ixu didn't have to burn any of his. Ixu also with TP advantage now because Someday had to use his to contest the dragon.
A teleport, ignite, a phage, and home guard boots. He's certainly skirmish ready if he chooses to come in across the map. There's not actually a lot of vision down for Anarchy. This has usually been one of their strong points, but early vision seems to be in the advantage of KT.
And there we go, tower for tower. So all that was accomplished by that from KT Rolster was a lot of summoner spell burned and an Ixu escape.
And a lot of time for Sungyun to not quite bring up the CS disadvantage, but probably enough time to farm the Blade of the Ruined King. We're waiting to see what he purchases as he gets back. Blade is finished, boots to go with it. Infinity Edge, there's always the chance that you get a couple of crits and able to take down the very low base stats of Vayne, but if Vayne's paid optimally, most of the time can happily duel a Sivir.
Yeah, you said it though, the vision just not what it usually is for Anarchy this time around. I think they've been a little bit frazzled by the fast pace that KT has been playing at. Trying to move into the river right now, starting to get some of these wards down, but they have to be very careful. Nagne approaching level 11 on this Kassadin. See what he goes for as his second item. Probably just going to be an Abyssal Scepter, but
about a 14-minute Rod of Ages, so we're talking about a 24-minute 10-stack Rod of Ages power spike to consider. Around that time, Rumble and Sivir basically be at full power, and the Rengar will only start to fall away. After the next item, you have to assume it's probably going to be tankiness. Maybe Black Cleaver? Is that where you go with the build at this point? You do have the physical damage of Arrow. That's going to mean if you shred the armor, the Ricochet is going to be doing a lot of damage. But it's a very expensive item to build from the jungle.
Yeah, I really don't think you can go that right there. Score actually using his ult, throwing out a Bola, just airballing it. Not really a lot of potential. They're going to try and dive this anyway, actually. There's a TP coming in from Ixu, so they're going to defend. Snowflower actually lives through that, but can they defend the turret? Still poke, hitting Anarchy's front line right there. Lear is going to come in. He has his ultimate to disengage this if he needs to.
Yeah, four melee champions and a Sivir. Sivir does good turret damage, but the wave is pretty strong from Anarchy. Waiting to see the next round of death. With the blue buff, you'd have to think they're going to be just fine, so a lot expended for nothing.
Wow, that was so much invested from KT. Now, they did prep the side waves pretty well before that happened, so they deny some CS. They could probably take away this red buff at the same time as they start to creep forward with a few wards into the enemy jungle, and maybe they can transition onto a tier two as they keep on poking in the mid lane.
Some of the good KT strategy is starting to sneak and rear its end in this game. They're going to take the outer turret in the mid. They've already taken the red buff. They had excellent waves in both top and bot. Okay, bit gimmicky with the team comp, but the execution, very good, despite the fact that the actual pick couldn't happen under the mid turret.
Yeah, that is true. It was still a little bit of shaky play, I think, in the early game, especially around that dragon. We'll see if they can pick the next one up in a little bit more of a clean fashion. And Ixu starting to work on that Trinity Force. He's very far away from it, though. Someday doesn't quite have that haunting guys yet. He will after he goes back right here. We'll see if he has it up for the needlessly large rod as well. He will.
Wow.
Yeah, he hadn't been back in quite some time.
I didn't appreciate the fact 10 CS ahead also has two out of the team's three kills. So this is going to be the rarely seen, especially tonight, carry rumble build. The backline threat onto Vayne. Vayne cannot afford to sit in an overheaded flame spinner.
Nope, not at all. So now the pushout begins. Ward's already in place for KT. Fixer starting to move to defend his pink wards right there. Anarchy doing a good job of countering. Actually, both those wards cleared out by nice pinks from Anarchy. Or, ooh, that one's quite just a little bit outside range, looks like.
Surprised to see that Victor is going the Abyssal Scepter second in a team comp where he is basically the sole wave clear. Of course, Gragas might be maxing the barrel first. I didn't actually see, but the barrel roll can provide some backup wave clear. Merlin Omicron, even before a Hexcore upgrade, has been some of the rushes that we've seen in other games, so surprised to see him just go purely for the magic penetration.
Yeah, especially with that Vayne on the team as well. There's not a lot of other options for Anarchy at this point, unless they want to get into melee range with that Hecarim.
This has been the person who has benefited the most from the early game. They've given so much space for Sungyun. This is definitely a game where they're looking to Sungyun to carry, and given how the lane started, 30 CS behind still is not ideal, but they've tried to engineer safe places for Sungyun to pick up both experience and farm.
Now, can they get a pick right here? They have been trying to hide in a brush with this Rengar to see if they can pick someone up before Anarchy actually approaches this dragon.
Zonya's they're trying to completed be completed on Rumble.
Ooh, that's big. They're trying to be a little bit sneaky right here. Score with all of his fury stacked up already.
Early teleport, Marin, also very Marin-esque, and just being in the position, of course, the threat of the backline without home guard boots. And on Rumble in general, it's more about positioning rather than necessarily rushing the backline a la Hecarim. So no teleport for Ixus, so can't go for any split pushes of his own, and the dragon is alive.
It is indeed. So will KT actually look to try and create a pick? There's the ultimate used by Rengar. He's going to jump onto Vicky immediately, and there's the Requiem, or the Equalizer, rather. And Mickey just gets destroyed instantly. Double kill for Someday. Ixu going to shut him down, however, and Nagme still not really a part of this fight right now. Starting to wrap around, wants the kill on Illyria, going to find Illyria body slamming through, and there will be eventually Riftwalk for the Kassadin, and that'll finish it off.
Yeah, important pick onto Mickey. It ended up being a masterstroke for KT. They were comfortable with going for the Sivir Kassadin. That almost was more than they probably expected. I think they'd committed to Kassadin as the counterpick to Victor. Of course, Victor much better when he doesn't have to deal with the Riftwalk or anyone engaging straight on top of him. There's a reason that Assassins was seen as one of the best ways to deal with him, both in lane and in-game. We're going to see the replay. Finally make a big play with the Throw of the Hunt. The Equalizer, with all the extra AP, burns Mickey down. Nothing he can do. From there, you can just see that Sungyun is just completely chased out of the fight. First Arrow is damaging him, and then Nagne, of course, flash Riftwalks into the backline, so we don't need to see. We can fill in the blanks on what's happening with the Kassadin. At this point, Arrow's alive. All the threats are gone for Anarchy, so it's just clean up from here.
Yeah, very easy, and then nice positioning from Nagne, too, taking the long way around, but just cutting off Lyra's possible escape route so he can finish off the kill. And that'll be another dragon for KT Rolster, 7-1 on the scoreboard for them so far.
And it's basically a god mode early game Rumble. You could not ask for more items at 21 minutes. Double magic penetration and the Zonya's, both a backline threat and just the Equalizer potentially running through a team. The flexibility of a build like this is purely the onus is on getting ahead in the early game. You don't see it a lot with the Rumbles today. They've been basically fighting with scraps, but while we talk so much about Rumble having a low item floor, it doesn't mean that if you throw in a cheeky Zonya's, he's not going to be that much stronger.
Well, it's also the lack of range. If you want to maximize your damage as Victor, you have to get in Q auto range. And Vayne with that short range also, which means that the Zonya's is going to be particularly effective against the carries of Anarchy by cutting their damage dramatically, because you could create a massive zone with Flamespitter Zonya's where simply the other team can't go unless they want to take a tremendous amount of damage onto their carries. You're also being bolstered by the fact that the Abyssal Scepter is complete for Nagne, so it's doing double duty to help Rumble get that damage in.
Everything is set up for a massive Equalizer in the next fight, and Rumble in general to boss around the short to mid-range threats, Victor and Vayne. I think it's well summarized there. So that just means that Anarchy don't have a lot of options. They were in a similar spot last game, and KT took the foot off the pedal in one of the most emphatic ways that I've ever seen. So it's a lot to hope for. It's not in Anarchy's control. You never want to be waiting for the enemy to make a mistake, but
here we go.
Dangerous in that way. He's ulted.
Ulting again. He wants Mickey. He's going to draw the flash out at the very least, and now they're going to push forward under the turret. How far do they want to dive? Ixu gets the flank, and that'll cause KT to disengage.
But Ixu just getting, basically taking AoE magic damage, not even targeted at him, is at half health, so a lot of damage threats to respect. They have very good turret damage. Ixu's going to teleport back. He probably has Homeguard boots available and Trinity Force, so maybe going to look for a fight. No, just rushing back to lane. Doesn't want to commit to the teleport. Ignite's going to be up soon. Anarchy have good wave clear, but as noted, don't have cooldown reduction, so it's gated by cooldowns.
Well, and the equalizer's still available. They're going to try and move forward on this arrow, taking a bit of a turret shot right there, actually. Going to be a pretty low after that, so no tier 2 for KT. They don't feel like pressing forward, despite having that equalizer available just to knock him off the tower. I think you just dropped that right there and see if you could chunk him out.
Maybe just a momentary lapse. Let's not get too many war flashbacks from last game.
Well, he certainly has the damage right now is the thing. And when you have that amount of poke damage against the Anarchy composition and you've already eliminated a few of them from the defense, you can certainly afford to place an equalizer aggressively. It's on a relatively short cooldown anyway.
And everyone on Anarchy is a squishy. Make no mistake, Trinity Force, Merc Treads, Hecarim will die very quickly to both the equalizer and any semblance of damage coming through. From just the rumble we're speaking about, there's not much health built, there's no resist built, barring a couple of cheeky null magic mantles. Someday is in a huge point of power. It's not necessarily he's going to be outscaled, but KT should do something with this advantage.
Absolutely. I think you just power up your siege right there and continue to snowball. Yeah, you've got a 6,000 gold lead, and that's wonderful, but KT lost out by not actually pressing hard enough in the last game, which is unusual for them as a team.
Arrow just popped an Elixir of Wrath. He's doing so much damage with the Yomu's Ghostblade. If one person has built for the mid-game, it is certainly Arrow.
Yeah, definitely has. Tired of not doing damage, this time just getting consumables to deal even more.
Well, it gives him the lifesteal that, of course, he hasn't been able to itemize in because he's gone very much for the duelist.
Here we go again.
Thrill of the Hunt once again, but not on the Thrill of the Hunt. No Sivir ultimate pop just yet. Siege is not necessarily their friend with only a 500 range Sivir, and they have to back away.
Well, what they have to do is actually really commit to using these ultimates to chunk him down. Now, Arrow is slowly winning the battle against Ixu in the top side, but he's not going to be able to do so alone.
And of course, it has used a consumable. That's 400 gold of what will eventually be, no doubt, a Bloodthirster that's committed to fighting in the next 3 minutes. If they do get a team fight in, of course, the amount of buff duration will extend on kills and assists. So I think not enough players pick up this Elixir of Wrath when they're in a position to, and they've been kind of out-rotated, so they're at least going to lose their turret.
Mickey gets the headbutt. Arrow's there on the side. Big, big boomerang blade, but he'll get taken out of harm's way with the Lantern. Can they commit? Missed Bola. Big equalizer. That's going to be it someday. And Arrow tag-teaming for a kill into the back line. That long-range engage doing them favors. They want to get this next dragon.
And that's the threatening equalizer with the AP behind that burned down Mickey and zoned the rest of the fight. So now they're actually looking more towards the turrets. They're definitely prioritizing turrets that will be very hard to siege in a traditional sense of their combo. Of course, when it's 5v3, turret will die instantly. Even Rengar doing massive turret damage. And they're going to try and take two.
Yeah, can they keep pushing forward? I think you just go back and take the dragon here.
It's the third dragon. It's a very crucial one. It gives you a 38-minute fifth dragon if that is a necessary win condition and wasn't even enough for them last game.
Oh,
you go in
pick.
Again.
Yeah. Oh. Ghostblade used. There comes Score from the side. He's got the root onto Lyra. Big explosive cast. Lyra still gets knocked around and into harm's way. Songyun takes a bunch of damage, but again, Snowflower with the Lantern. Turn around now. With the onslaught of Shadow, Someday still firing harpoons. They've got control of the brush, Someday.
So much rumble damage. Doesn't get both kill credits, but certainly did the lion's share of the damage. Three more kills to pad the stats, 12-1, two turrets to zero. 9K gold lead, we've seen crazier things, but finally KT doing well as Someday just completes the recall. He takes the damage, actually. I believe he took
That was weird.
That was really weird.
So actually what happened there was he took the secondary damage from the victor because he was standing there, I think, was what it was. That must have been it, right?
Yep.
Uh-oh. Strange.
Score has to flash away from Victor. So Victor doing damage and forcing summoner spells as best as he can, does Mickey.
So that's very weird. If you're recalling on the space where the death laser hits after you've recalled and the second damage from the upgraded hex door
would have hit you.
Would have hit you. You take the damage in fountain. Neat.
We're learning new words today. We're learning new interactions. I believe we had some excellent chats about lore.
That is so weird how that is coded.
It's probably coded as minions.
Yeah.
It's a couple of Teemos just doing a bit of extra auto attack damage.
Very funny.
Look, Someday is 7-1-1, 41 CS up on his opponent. That is a disgusting amount of damage.
Well, you know, already at the three core items as well. That's going to be extremely helpful for him.
And I'm pretty disappointed. Where is the death cap? That's the Marin specials when he's like, he just throws a death cap into the build.
I think Deathcap's actually better than Liandry's here because Ixu just doesn't have that much HP yet.
And I think with the interaction, I was actually reading on Twitter that I believe you cannot buy an Abyssal Scepter and have it affect lane minions, so Deathcap actually gives you some side pushing options as well, just with the sheer amount of AP adding up to that Flame Spitter damage. KT can dive, KT can split push. Hecarim's trying to feign aggression but has no teleport, so doesn't need to be concerned about that at all.
Yep, and here we go. KT now starting to auto this turret. Even Nagne getting in on the action in the front line. And this should just be a cakewalk for KT. Now, we said that last game,
too. Oh, boy,
too.
These are big words.
Now, here we go. Here is
on the thrill of the hunt pop. They've seen Sunfire Force versus a huge equalizer, but it's only a zoning one. Splits the team, but Nagne has flash available. Victor's dead. No semblance of wave clear left. So it's going to be, at minimum, an inhibitor.
Yeah, now they power through the turret. Inhibitor going to be the focus. Not really a way that Anarchy can defend against this whatsoever. That Vayne gets close. That will be a very crispy Vayne if Someday has his way. Now they've already prepped the wave in the mid lane as well.
Don't die on me, Monty.
It's been a long week.
It's been a long night, too. So they prepped the wave, but unfortunately it's just a single minion, so they have to back away. Gets hooked here to Someday, but doesn't have equalizer. Still don't
nice
know if you want to do this
equal.
Yeah, it's still riding onto the Alistar. He's tanking it up. So Nane in the back line takes down Sungyoon. Mickey hasn't even got back to the fight yet. Doesn't have home guard boots. It's going to be at minimum this inhibitor. And I think this time we're talking about a decisive lead for KT.
Yeah, 16-1 in terms of kills already. 4-0-8 for Nagne's Kassadin, looking much, much better than they did the last game. Pretty much crushing all of the lanes this time around. Everyone with 3 to 4 deaths on Anarchy.
And I can tell you one thing, Monte Cristo. Arrow this game does damage.
He definitely does. We don't have any questions about that any longer. Not quite into Bloodthirster range yet. Now, how much do they want this Baron to close things out? And, you know, to score's credit, he actually has done a lot of work this game as well, but the question is, could he have done it on a different jungler instead? I would say that his Evelynn is definitely capable of producing the same kind of results.
I would say that the unique thing that Rengar has provided them is when we saw the engage onto the Gragas that was over the Raptor wall. That's the sort of engage that you can't do without the Thrill of the Hunt. So I feel like he's gotten some unique angles. He's gotten picks that weren't possible last game when the Gragas and the kite back comp they had for Kalista actually proved quite effective. Very hard to kite Rengar when he pops that ultimate, especially when we're talking about adding on the movement speed of the Thrill of the Hunt, so. So I agree, there's definitely could have engineered a similar result, but he's at least playing the Rengar much better than the last time we saw it this season.
That's true. I guess my other issue, too, is that the Thresh has denied so many possible Rengar
sure
ults already. So if you're going to leave the Thresh up, the Rengar does seem a bit ineffectual. Well, here we go. It's going to be the Siege onto Inhibitor number 3. No Baron takeaway yet for KT. Ixu looking for some damage in the front line, but that's not where you want to be.
He found plenty of damage. Unfortunately, it was from the Sivir. Someday's level 16, so this Equalizer will completely obliterate anyone on Anarchy's side. They want to layer it down, but don't really feel forced to, and that's a third Inhibitor, and surely the game.
Yeah, surely this will be KT turning onto Baron. Nope. Actually, Ixu just going to go in. There's a death ray.
Oh,
there
the Equalizer. Oh, massive into the back line. Thresh roasted. Lyra still alive, but going to fall soon. Ixu comes back into the fight because he realized this game is completely over. And at long last, 20-1. Those were probably the odds of good old Anarchy winning the previous game, but they managed to do it, but they certainly won't win this one.
They won't indeed, and KT comes again. They always deliver these very high kill wins. They're very good at playing around that Sivir. And after a bit of a scare in the last one, there really wasn't any hope for Anarchy in that last game, taking a pretty big deficit right from the beginning, and KT runs away with it.
KT answers some questions, unfortunately poses more, especially with their game too. They play well with Sivir, this part is established, but if that pick is off the table, or if they just opt away from it, we still have to really, we have to remain to be convinced. We need to be skeptical because they haven't shown much new this series.
No, they certainly haven't. And that vulnerability to the Sivir ban, you wonder why some of these other teams aren't taking it away from them, because they just put such an incredible priority on it. And the difference between their